Good afternoon, colleagues. I would remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus. I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is a debate without a motion on the subject of COVID-19. And I would invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on John Swinney, Cabinet Secretary, to open the debate. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. And may I begin by welcoming you to your office and wish you all good wishes as Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome this opportunity to open one of the first debates of this new Parliament on a topic of such importance to everyone in Scotland. Today's debate allows us to build on the strong commitments made by all political parties throughout the election period that the immediate priority for the next government was leading the country through the ongoing pandemic and into a fair and just recovery. Parliament has shaped our response to the virus. Now there is the opportunity and the necessity for Parliament to shape our recovery from the pandemic. I look forward to setting out the Scottish Government's ongoing response to COVID, our approach to recovery and the immediate steps we intend to take to bring the necessary energy and direction to this particular activity. But just as importantly, I also welcome the opportunity to build on the commitment made by the First Minister yesterday to cooperate with all political parties to put the interests of the country first. With that in mind, I look forward to a collaborative debate on how we work together across the Chamber and across sectors to realise our shared mission to build for the future. In reappointing me as Deputy First Minister last week, the First Minister also asked me to lead the cross-government and cross-parliament work necessary to guide the country through the pandemic and into a recovery that supports the National Health Service, protects and creates employment, backs our young people and contributes to Scotland's ambition to be a net zero nation, into a recovery that takes us closer to the kind of Scotland we all want to see, a country that is more equal and one that eradicates child poverty, a country where the economy is guiding us towards a more sustainable future with jobs and opportunities for all, a country that values, protects and promotes its natural environment, its cultural heritage and its technological innovation, a country with public services that meet the needs of its citizens efficiently, effectively and with compassion. It is a great privilege to be asked to lead that mission and a responsibility that I am determined to discharge with pace and in an inclusive way. It is, however, clear that despite the undoubted progress that we have made as a country, the pandemic is not yet over. I want to take this opportunity to express my sincere thanks and the thanks of the whole government to all who have already committed so much to supporting the country throughout the pandemic and continue to do so in the National Health Service and Social Care, in the Police Service and across the whole public sector, as well as businesses and third sector organisations. The past year has been difficult, stressful and heartbreaking for so many people across Scotland. We must remember those who we have lost as we continue to grapple with the grief and the stress that comes with bereavement. Many people continue to battle the consequences of the pandemic that have impacted people's health, social ties and livelihoods. It has been hard for so many in our country. I understand the urgency with which all of us want to get back to as normal a life as possible. ICU and hospital COVID-19 admissions remain at low levels, and in much of the country, cases remain at relatively low levels. Due to the progress that we have made in suppressing the virus, we have been able to begin cautiously easing restrictions and even bring forward some of the easings when the data indicated it was safe for us to do so. We still need to be cautious, not least in terms of international travel. The risk of importation of new cases and variants from international travel remains, and so we are asking people to think carefully about whether they really need to travel at this particular time. And as we begin to look ahead and prepare for life after the pandemic, it is essential that we continue to protect ourselves and each other from the spread of the virus. As we have seen in Glasgow and in some other local authority areas, case numbers can quickly increase, and we are not yet free of this virus. I'm hopeful that over time we may be able to move away from the use of lockdowns and severe restrictions on our freedoms to deal with increasing cases and instead to take a more targeted approach using our high-performing test and protect system, enhanced surveillance and local outbreak management to contain and to control increasingly sporadic outbreaks. But to do that, we still need people to do their part, though. Maintain good hygiene, to wear a face covering and physically distance where required. If people have symptoms, they should isolate and get tested. And even if they do not have symptoms, people should make use of the universal testing offer and get tested regularly. But above all, people need to get vaccinated. To date, 3,174,807 people have received the first dose of the COVID vaccination in Scotland, and 1,942,285 people have received the second dose of the COVID vaccination. We remain on course to have offered vaccination to the adult population by the end of July. We will look back on this as one of the greatest single achievements of both science and the value of the public sector working together in this endeavour. But we must continue to be on our guard. Of course.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. Does this also, the success of the vaccination programme, does it also show the benefits of the UK Government and the Scottish Government working together with a single objective in mind? Is that not a stellar example of what can be achieved when we come together and work together?
I'm all for governments working together on agreed common purposes and doing that in an open and a transparent way, where we have the benefit of substantive and detailed engagement on the formulation and the execution of policy. So this is Mr Kerr is right, this is a very good example of that. I could spend the rest of the afternoon giving Mr Kerr a litany of examples where it's not the case, where we don't get enough substantive engagement with the United Kingdom Government, but I don't think that was really the purpose of his intervention. So I will desist from entertaining Parliament with my views on that matter this afternoon, but I'm happy, I'm certain on other occasions to be able to share that with Mr Kerr. I hear there's some disappointment in my own backbenches about the fact that I'm not engaging in that, but I'm trying to be on my best behaviour this afternoon. Presiding Officer, we do, despite the progress on the vaccination strategy, we must continue to be on our guard. We've seen that new variants, including the April 02 variant, can impact on case numbers. We are tracking the latest science, which indicates that while more transmissible, two doses of either vaccine continue to offer high levels of protection against the April 02 variant. That means we should hopefully continue to see a significant reduction in the number of people hospitalised and who die from COVID. But to achieve wider protection, we need the whole adult population to be vaccinated. So when citizens are offered the vaccine, even if individuals think they are fit and healthy, they should take it, if not for themselves, then for the sake of everyone else who may be more vulnerable to the effects of infection. Too many vaccination appointments are being missed. Sometimes that is unavoidable. But we are taking steps to make it as easy as possible and to reach those who are often furthest away from health services. If we can continue to progress on vaccination and make full use of Test and Protect, I firmly believe we can progress in the way that we have set out in our plans. Of course.
I'm grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. On this issue of vaccination, we know that there have been issues with a major problem with people not turning up for appointments. What work is the Scottish Government trying to do to understand why that should be and try and address this issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's very detailed engagement going on that very question, because as the Health Secretary made clear in answers to questions earlier on this week, we find that situation to be unacceptable. So there is work going on in relation to the administrative processes as to whether or not addresses are up to date, as to whether systems are being updated satisfactorily in that respect. But then also essentially turning some of the issues on their head in providing people with the opportunity to essentially register for vaccination purposes. And we've seen fantastic uptake of the invitation to over 18s to register for vaccination, and the Health Secretary will say more about that. So there are a number of very practical steps been taken to enhance uptake of vaccination, because it is so critical to the steps that we need to take to make further progress in suppression of the virus. We have, Presiding Officer, substantial reviews coming up that could lead, that could see large parts of Scotland move to level one. In parallel, we intend to publish more detailed work on our expectations for life beyond level zero, as we return hopefully to something that we all recognise is much closer to normal than even level zero restrictions. In that work, we will set out the protections we all need to keep in place and how we can all play our part. We will give clarity to people and businesses looking beyond level zero to the summer and the second half of the year. However, as we have seen, the situation can change quickly, and we will continue to monitor the situation constantly and respond effectively as soon as we judge it necessary to do so. Where we need to take tough decisions, we will share the data and the reasoning behind the judgments that we make and give as much notice of any changes as we possibly can do. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government will, of course, continue to take the necessary decisions to guide the country safely through the pandemic. But thanks to the success of the vaccination programme and the extraordinary sacrifices made by people across Scotland over the past 14 months, we can be optimistic about the future and start the journey towards national recovery. A serious recovery needs a quick response from government, which is why we have published the key health, social and economic actions we will take within the first 100 days of this government. Our immediate priority is to lead Scotland out of the pandemic, to reopen the country as quickly and as safely as we can. Alongside our work on recovery, we will take rapid action to boost jobs, tackle the climate crisis, support our children and young people, and protect our National Health Service. The NHS has faced extraordinary pressure during the pandemic, and as we move towards recovery, we must help the NHS to do the same. We have already implemented a 4% average pay rise for NHS workers. Within 100 days, we will publish an NHS National Recovery Plan to increase activity by 10% and start a consultation on a national care service. Our resilience to the pandemic has been drawn from our sense of community. The Scottish Government will continue to invest in our communities and in our homes. We will support our most vulnerable and disadvantaged communities to ensure that those who have been worst affected by the pandemic are prioritised in our recovery. We will roll out a £20 million summer programme of help for pupils, supporting activities that allow our children and families a much-deserved chance to socialise, play and reconnect. We will also provide low-income families with the first £100 of a total of £520 of support, the equivalent of the Scottish Child Payment. We have set out how in the first 100 days we will establish a cross-party steering group looking to progress the delivery of the Scottish Minimum Income Guarantee. We will begin to develop a new rented sector strategy and start cladding safety assessment. And we will start work to develop our new five-year social isolation and loneliness plan backed by £10 million over the duration of the Parliament. On the economy, within 100 days, we will create a Council of Economic Transformation to shape a new 10-year strategy for economic development. We will reopen the Digital Boost Fund, backed by £25 million, providing technology support and training for small and medium-sized businesses. We will set up a new Green Jobs Workforce Academy to help people get the skills they need to move into new, greener jobs. This is one example of how our recovery from the pandemic must be linked to actions that address the climate crisis.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy First Minister for taking an intervention. We talked about our opportunity here to have an economic recovery that drives a green economy towards net zero in 2045. Can I ask what the Scottish Government are doing to ensure that our youngsters have the ability to access courses that will be required to deliver on that, meaning we can rely on our own youngsters rather than import that kind of resource?
It's very important that our education system addresses the skills requirements of the future economy, and the government is signalling very clearly the agenda of achieving net zero. We have to configure our education system to support that, and of course, as Mr Whittle will be aware from his local connections, our college system and our university community are very well connected with all of these areas of activity, and these different skill requirements will be reflected in the opportunities that are taken forward by our colleges and universities, and of course, perfectly able to be delivered through Scotland's school curriculum. We will be put centre stage as a country as we play host to COP26, the UN Climate Summit in November. Last week, the First Minister appointed a new Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, Energy and Transport, and Ministers for Youth Employment and Just Transition. In the first 100 days of government, we will launch a national campaign to raise awareness of the climate crisis and announce the locations of Scotland's first low-carbon vertical farms. Whilst being far from everything we will do in these 100 days, the Government's plans touch on almost every area of policy. It will also help us to create the right conditions to build on our existing commitments to reform and to renew Scotland's public services in ways that improve the lives and experiences of our people, communities and places. With these commitments, we set the stage for a bold and ambitious programme for a better, fairer and more prosperous future for our country. The purpose of our plan for the first 100 days of government is to bring energy, direction and momentum to recovery. It will also set the tone for delivery of the longer-term recovery commitments made in our manifesto and set out yesterday by the First Minister in her statement to Parliament on the priorities of the government. The delivery of the commitments that we made to the country is my immediate priority. Achieving that will require the government to work across boundaries and across sectors. A key part of my role is to ensure that the Scottish Government's combined effort delivers the greatest possible impact for the people of Scotland. In embracing this fundamental delivery challenge of working creatively and collaboratively across organisational and sectoral boundaries, I'm conscious of the inspiration that can be derived from the way Scotland has responded to the pandemic up to this point. In responding to the shock and disruption that COVID-19 brought to all of our lives, national government, local government, businesses, third sector organisations and individual citizens found new and creative solutions to the challenges that faced us. We did it because we had to. The National Vaccination Programme provides an obvious example of that, but so do the times where we were not constrained by the way the system had previously worked and instead focused on delivering for the individual. Examples such as the cash-first approach to supporting disadvantaged families, where national and local government worked together to ensure the people who needed it the most received money direct to their pockets, to provide meals for their children during periods of school closures or school holidays, and to address financial insecurity during the winter months. It was also seen in the collaborative response from local authorities, health boards and frontline homelessness organisations, supported by funding from the Scottish Government, which has brought the number of people sleeping rough in Scotland to a record low, a position that we would not have believed possible before the pandemic. I am determined to harness the spirit of solidarity, collaboration and innovation that was so evident during the toughest periods of the pandemic and focus that on our recovery. In doing so, I am challenging my ministerial colleagues to work across their portfolios to deliver the first 100 days' commitments and to ensure that cross-cutting issues such as net zero, the tackling of poverty, the addressing of inequalities, the expansion of our digital footprint and ensuring that public services are holistic and focused on the needs of individuals are fully incorporated into recovery planning. It is also a challenge I'm making to our delivery partners to retain the collaboration that has guided us through our continued COVID response and focus that on our COVID recovery. We are already seeing that spirit. Yes.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful and apologise for the loud shout from the back. To encompass that paragraph that you've just described, if we look at the £20 million that's been guided for the summer support for young children, are you confident that that will be able to be delivered in 4 weeks, which is, of course, the start of the summer holidays for the children here in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I am confident about that. Discussions have been going on with local authorities principally. The fund is split into essentially two components. A distribution to local authorities where there has been extensive engagement throughout the pre-election period. And then also £5 million is being allocated to a range of national organisations who have submitted propositions to the government about how these proposals can be delivered. So I think that combination of locally configured schemes to enhance the work that has been put forward by individual authorities, plus the national schemes that will be available and delivered by some familiar organisations with whom we will all be familiar, I think provides the necessary assurance to Mr Whitfield, but of course we will continue to explore these issues. One of the other examples of collaboration is the work the Government has taken forward with the Hunter Foundation, where we are partnering with the Hunter Foundation to deliver an ambitious programme of mentoring and leadership, which was announced back in March, to support young people most impacted by the pandemic. The contribution of £7.5 million from the Hunter Foundation over the next 6 years will add value to this programme and, combined with our existing £19.4 million commitment, will significantly improve the life chances of the young people who participate, many of whom are young people who have been most affected and, by the pandemic. When I met with partners from across the public, private and voluntary sectors on Tuesday, I was struck by the common conclusion that the last 14 months have seen a step change in how we work together for the benefit of all of our citizens. And a number of partners stressed the point that COVID has shone a light on and magnified inequalities in our society. And one of the points underlies the intervention from Mr. Whitfield. I also heard vividly that some of our small businesses feel that they are still in the middle of the pandemic and that we need to listen to the frustrations that they have felt in their interactions with both national and local government and to address those particular questions. Our challenge now is to use recovery as an opportunity to build forward and on a fairer basis. The Scottish Government cannot do this alone. This must be a national endeavour, using all of the levers we have at our disposal, but working with partners and across sectors to lead the change that we want to see. This is the challenge that I address before this new Parliament today. I know that our best chances to build a legacy out of the pandemic for the generations that come after us lie in working together. The Government is committed to bringing people together from a wide range of sectors and backgrounds in pursuit of the strongest possible recovery. And I know that all parties in the Scottish Parliament are determined to support this endeavour, which is why I have established a new cross-party steering group on COVID recovery. This group met for the first time yesterday and had a positive initial discussion. We've agreed to consider in detail some core issues that need to be addressed in COVID recovery, and we have committed to working together to make sure that recovery is as broadly based in our society and supported as it possibly can be. There will, of course, be many issues for us to confront, but the more that we can do that in open, honest conversation between parties, the better, and the stronger will be the reaction and the response to the challenges that lie ahead. In closing, Presiding Officer, I'm immensely proud of and grateful for the way in which our country has come together to respond to the challenges posed by the pandemic. Everyone in this country has been impacted in some way, and that continues today. But as we focus our energies on our recovery, we have the opportunity to come together again as across organisational, sectoral and political boundaries to work with the communities we serve to improve people's lives. That would be a legacy of which we could all be very proud.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I call Murdo Fraser to open for the Conservatives. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start my first contribution debate in this new Parliament by welcoming you to your place? Can I also welcome the Deputy First Minister to his new role in leading for the Government on COVID recovery? And as he's also on the front bench, welcome Hamza Youssef to his new role as Cabinet Secretary for Health, and we'll be hearing from him later. And it is, as this is the first debate in this new session, I'm sure we'll hear a number of first speeches from new members, and I look forward to hearing their contributions in the course of the afternoon. It is entirely appropriate that this first debate in this new Parliament is on the subject of COVID recovery. The COVID pandemic has been the most serious health and economic challenge that will have affected any of us in our lifetimes. We made the point during the recent election campaign that the unrelenting focus of government for the next 5 years needs to be on the issue of COVID recovery, and that remains our view. And I welcome the fact that we are debating this topic not just this afternoon, but throughout the whole of next week in addition. I would join with the Deputy First Minister in paying tribute to all those who have worked so hard to protect the public, those in the NHS and the care service, those in other public services such as in teaching, the police, the fire service, the military, in social work and across local government. We should also recognise that it is not just in the public sector that people have made sacrifices. There are many private sector employers who have gone the extra mile to provide safe working environments for their staff, and there are businesses which have had to adapt rapidly to provide safe services to their customers, displaying a degree of imagination and innovation in doing so. But despite all that, the impact of COVID has been devastating. It has been devastating in terms of lives lost. It has been devastating in terms of the wider impact on the NHS, with delayed and cancelled operations, long waiting lists, and a long list of undiagnosed treatments. There is also a huge and largely hidden story about the social impacts of COVID-19 restrictions, a growth in loneliness and isolation, a huge negative impact on mental health, the effects of which we are probably not likely to fully understand for some years to come. Now, we all understand why restrictions on lives were necessary, why lockdowns had to be introduced to control the spread of COVID to prevent the NHS being overwhelmed. But we should never forget that these lockdowns came at an enormous cost, both socially and economically, with vast sums having to be spent by governments to support individuals, businesses and communities. According to the latest estimate, the UK government has pumped some £23 billion into the Scottish economy. And whilst that is most welcome, that level of support cannot be provided on an indefinite and ongoing basis. And even with that, we see rising unemployment, people losing their jobs, businesses failing, and even those which are surviving are doing so with mountains of additional debt that will burden them for many years to come. Earlier this week, the First Minister signalled what seemed to be a change in the Scottish Government's approach to COVID, with a shift away from an elimination strategy to one of suppression. That is a welcome shift. We now know that COVID is going to be with us for the long term. We see new variants of the virus appearing, and more will develop in the future. Even if eradicating COVID were possible, it would come at the cost of more ongoing restrictions, more lockdowns, and closing our borders entirely on a long-term basis. And I do not believe that these are realistic objectives at this time. I do not believe that we can afford another lockdown or yet more restrictions. We should be looking to open up, not to close down. A suppression strategy which allows a general relaxation of restrictions, but clamping down quickly in specific geographic locations where a rise in cases is identified, with surge testing and rapid increases in vaccination, must be the right approach to take as we go forward. And I think the Deputy First Minister did recognise that in his opening statements. And just as we have had to learn to live with, for example, seasonal flu outbreaks, we're going to have to learn to live with COVID in the future. The biggest weapon in our armoury against COVID and allowing us to relax restrictions more quickly has been the extraordinary success of the vaccination programme. We should pay tribute to the UK government for having the vision and foresight to establish this back last summer, at a time when there were many voices saying that they were taking the wrong approach. Today, the UK is a world leader amongst major nations in vaccinating the population, and that is the way we will keep people safe and be able to relax restrictions more quickly. The vaccination programme is not, however, without its difficulties. As I alluded to earlier, we saw last weekend that just one half of those who had been given appointments for vaccines at the SECC in Glasgow on a particular day had attended. And we've heard from elsewhere in the country a large level of no-shows, particularly as we move towards vaccinating younger age groups. It is essential that the Scottish Government gets on top of this issue and understands the reasons why people are not turning up for appointments. Is there a problem with the computer systems? Is there a problem with the company that has been contracted to dispatch the letters? Are too many letters going out to addresses which are no longer relevant because people have moved? Are individuals being offered appointments at inconvenient times or inconvenient locations where they do not have transport? Is there a general reluctance amongst some individuals or some groups to take up vaccines? I do not know the answers to these questions, but they need to be answered very quickly if we are to achieve the objective of vaccinating the great majority of the population within the next few weeks. And I'm sure that the Cabinet Secretary for Health will address some of these questions when he winds up the debate shortly. Now, I've talked, Presiding Officer, a little about the impact of the pandemic on the NHS, and I want to say more about the impact on the economy. We have seen an enormous strain on many businesses as a result of COVID restrictions. The grant support paid by the Scottish Government has been welcome. But I have made the point before, and I will do so again, that too many businesses and individuals have fallen through the net. We should be looking at where the gaps are and who still needs support. Nowhere have the problems for business been more acute than in the areas of tourism and hospitality, where restrictions have seriously inhibited their ability to trade. Even as these restrictions are now being lifted, there are hospitality businesses which are teetering on the brink of survival. Many who have spoken to me cannot understand why restrictions are applying to them that do not apply elsewhere in the UK, or why there should appear to be inconsistencies in approach between different sectors. A good example of this is in the events industry. We've seen the cancellation of a large number of events which provide tremendous economic benefit to the country. The agricultural shows that go on across the summer in our rural communities, the Edinburgh Festival, the Edinburgh Military Tattoo, in my own area, the Rewind Music Festival at Scone Palace. These are all events which bring in thousands, if not tens of thousands, of people to local communities, and the cancellation of them is devastating, both for the events venues themselves and has a huge negative knock-on effect on the wider economy. The planning of these events takes many months, and what events venues are looking for is some certainty for the future so they can forward plan, a route map for the future. And a similar plea comes from the wedding sector, which has now effectively lost two summer seasons for weddings. Weddings are now permitted with up to 50 guests, but still with restrictions on live music, which means that many couples are still not wanting to go ahead until they can have the full experience they want with their family and friends. I know of couples who have had to rebook their weddings now three times, which is not only frustrating for them, but causes huge disruption and economic loss to the wedding venues, to the caterers, the dress suppliers, the hairdressers, the photographers, and all the others whose livelihoods depend upon weddings taking place. These are the sectors who need certainty, who need a forward plan, and that can be provided by the Scottish Government. We have also seen huge disruption in the area of education, which the Deputy First Minister referred to, with too many young people having been left behind over the past year. And despite the best efforts of teachers and other staff in schools, the experience of home learning, particularly during the first lockdown, was not always as good as it should have been. We currently see young people across Scotland facing exam-style assessments in schools, but with very little forward notice having been provided and no study leave, but having been told that these assessments will count towards their final grades. And this has caused a great deal of stress and concern amongst young people in that particular situation. And after a year of confusion and uncertainty, it is little wonder that many are disillusioned by their experience of education. Now, we had ideas in our manifesto to bring forward new ideas for improving the situation in education, a dedicated catch-up fund, a national tutoring programme, and I would encourage the Scottish Government to look at these and consider whether these could be adopted, because otherwise we're in danger of seeing a group of young people, a cohort, particularly those in senior school, having their life chances adversely affected because of the negative experience too many have had over the past year or so. And then we saw a similar problem for that same group of young people, those slightly older, who were going to be students at Scottish universities for the first time last autumn. Some finding themselves trapped, effectively trapped in halls of residence with online classes only, not being allowed to go out, not being allowed to socialise due to COVID restrictions. And we should not make sure that happens again as we approach the start of a new university year in September and October. Presiding officer, COVID has been an unprecedented challenge for all of us. Over the past year, mistakes have been made, and I hope that lessons have been learned. With the progress in the vaccination programme, I hope that we are now through the worst and on the road back to recovery across our economy, across our public services, and in society as a whole. I will finish where I started. It is our view that COVID recovery needs to be the unrelenting focus of the Scottish Government for the next 5 years, and if that is their focus, they will have our support. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. I now call Anna Sarwar to open for Labour. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I take this opportunity to welcome you to your new role and also in advance congratulate all those new members that will make their maiden speeches today. There is a huge challenge facing our country as we continue to come through this pandemic and we try and build that national recovery. And I think it's important to recognise right from the outset the tremendous work done by all those on the front line over the last year and more to get our country through this. Our thanks is not enough, though. We need to properly recognise and reward them coming through this pandemic. We also have to recognise that whilst governments, ministers and officials had to make really difficult decisions, the real sacrifices were made by families across the country who had to fulfil and implement those restrictions. And that's why it's incumbent on all of us to make sure that we can come through this as quickly as possible and then do the important work of rebuilding the country that we all love. There has been a sense of hope and optimism in recent months, And I think the important challenge for this Parliament is to make sure we build on that sense of hope and optimism and do not lose it. The defining mission of this Parliament has to be coming through this pandemic and making sure that we come through this most difficult year of our lifetime and build a fairer, more equal and greener nation together. I want to split my contribution into two parts, one about the current crisis and then about what we do in terms of focusing on the recovery phase. First, in terms of coming through this pandemic, we see hotspot areas, so this virus has not gone away. Lives and livelihoods are still at risk. The virus is still spreading far too fast in some communities across our country. In my own home neighbourhood of the south side of Glasgow, being one of those hotspot areas. But I think the big challenge that we face is whilst the government was praised rightly, I think, for its level of communication, particularly at the start of this pandemic, I think there is a real risk that that level of communication and public trust and confidence is at risk of breaking in terms of what is happening in the city of Glasgow. We need to see urgent action that gives a proper route map and exit plan for the city of Glasgow so we can keep hold of that hope and optimism. I gave some suggestions on that at the start of this week. I'm pleased to see that some of those suggestions have been put into practice, but I still think we have a long way to go. The way we are going to get through this crisis in those hotspot areas is not by having perpetual lockdowns and people having to wait to see on a Friday what their life looks like on a Monday. The way we do it is by having clear criteria of when a local area will face further restrictions, have proper channels of communication with businesses and with sectors, and to recognise that not only will the pandemic itself risk people's mental health and well-being, how we respond to the pandemic, the restrictions that we impose, and the consequences that will have, knock-on consequences on families, whether that be through education, whether that be losing jobs, whether that be an increase in poverty, those two also have a mental health and well-being impact on our society. And that's why... I'll take the invitation.
John Mason.
I thank the member very much for giving way. I just wonder if he would accept that if there's more notice given to businesses and others to when they can open, it could end up with businesses being closed for longer. So there's a dichotomy there about trying to balance these.
Anna Sarah.
Well, I think what the dichotomy is, I think it's unfair to tell a city that you can open up from Monday. People make the plans for that opening up. They buy the supplies, they tell the workforce to get ready to come back in. And then on the Friday, in a television studio, they're told, no, sorry, you have to wait another week. We are in a parliamentary democracy. We should be having statements of such importance made in this Parliament, not in a TV studio. So, I'll give you a practical example of that. We are in this Parliament today. Why is it that the BBC has been informed by the government that the First Minister will make a statement in a television studio tomorrow when we're sitting in a Parliament right now? Come into this Parliament right now, make that statement in this Parliament and allow the elected representatives of that local area to scrutinise those decisions in the interests of the people. I see the Cabinet Secretary wants to come in.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Mr Sarwar for giving way, and I think the government is available to make for parliamentary scrutiny at all times when Parliament is sitting. But the dilemma, and part of it is related to the point that John Mason raises, is that we want to provide as much opportunity as we possibly can do to be able to see the data that allows us to take decisions that, for example, in this circumstance, allow us to lift restrictions if that is possible to be undertaken. So there is a conflict between some of the timing to maximise the scrutiny that Parliament can exercise and the opportunities to give notice to individual communities. But we will always be available for parliamentary scrutiny.
And is that right?
Well, sadly, that's not the truth. If the First Minister is making a statement at 12:15 tomorrow, she's already planning what she's going to say in that statement. She's already looking at the data she's making in that statement. She could come to the Parliament right now, up until 5 o'clock. I'm happy to wait till later in the day, if necessary, for her to make those decisions for what's going to happen in the country, and therefore we can scrutinise those decisions. And actually, in the last Parliament, and this is the important point the Deputy First Minister misses, in the last Parliament, the First Minister was making those decisions on a Tuesday for what was going to happen the following Monday, not a Friday for what was going to happen on the next Monday. And that is a big difference for a business that has to plan ahead and for individual families. So what needs to happen, if this government is serious about parliamentary scrutiny, If it's serious about proper communication channels with the public, it needs to recognise that it comes to this Parliament, shares the data in advance, it comes to this Parliament, allows elected members to question in response, not relying on TV studios for that response to take place. And therefore, alongside that, let's have mass testing, PCR testing, in the city of Glasgow and in hotspot areas. Let's make Glasgow a blueprint of what happens in future hotspot areas. I know the Cabinet Secretary for Health in his response later on will say that we are doing more door-to-door PCR testing. Actually, if you look at the capacity, we're only doing 5,000 across the whole of the country, not just in one city of Glasgow where the hotspot exists. Let's have mass PCR testing. We also need rollout of the vaccine. The Deputy First Minister shouldn't be getting upset. I'm giving advice that's important to the people of Glasgow, so he shouldn't be getting upset about this. The second part, it's not wrong, it's true, 5,000, the figures are there published today. The second point is around the vaccine. The vaccine should be made available in hotspot areas immediately for anyone aged over 18 and above. We should have walk-in centres in hotspot areas where you don't need an appointment. You can just turn up, and if you're 18 and above, you get your vaccination. That should be happening right now. I saw a tweet from the Health Secretary 6 hours ago that said that if there is some availability now for people aged 18 and above in those hotspot areas. I'm sorry, the vast majority of people in the south side of Glasgow aren't sitting on Twitter. They need that communication about what's going to happen so they can access that vaccine. Alongside that, there are people who are having to struggle and choose, and we hear a lot from this government about how tough it is for those difficult decisions. I tell you, it pales into insignificance for the tough decisions an individual family has to make about whether they stay at home and self-isolate, or they risk other people's lives, risk their own lives and their family's lives, because they've got no choice but to go out and work so they can put food on the table. That's why we need to increase the accessibility of the self-isolation grants, and we've also got to look at the value of those self-isolation grants so no one has to make that difficult decision. Alongside that, when you saw what happened in Liverpool and in Manchester, when they went into higher levels of restrictions compared to the rest of England, those two cities rightly fought for extra business support for their communities. We need extra business support in the city of Glasgow and any other hotspot that goes into difficulty anywhere in the city, so we can make sure livelihoods are not lost and we don't have mass unemployment as a result. I'm sorry, I'm already over time, otherwise I would have taken it. Unless I'm getting time back, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm happy to take the intervention.
I think we're probably using up the extra
time.
Okay,
no problem. So that's the urgent action we need. Extra business support, more PCR testing, rapid access to the vaccination and greater accessibility to the self-isolation grant. Let's make Glasgow the blueprint rather than keeping people in perpetual lockdown. On the actual recovery part, I think the government underestimates the scale of the challenge that this country faces if they think a 100-day document is going to cut it. 100 days is not going to cut it. I mean, I think, to be honest, I hear the Cabinet Secretary for Education and the Cabinet Secretary for Recovery tutting and humming and hawing over this. This is really, really serious. Really, really serious. And the point I'm trying to make to the government is we are willing to work with the government on the COVID recovery group. It was a suggestion I made during the election campaign myself. The point I'm making, and this is not something to hum and haw at, is to recognise that this is a long-term challenge facing our country. And if we're serious about working together on it, then it needs long-term economic growth ideas. That means a jobs guarantee into the long term. It means recognising that the 1 year that children have missed on their education isn't going to be caught up in 100 days. It's going to take years to catch up on that. The SQA exams fiasco is coming before us again. We need to urgently avert that so no child loses out on opportunity and is part of some kind of lost generation coming through this pandemic. And we need to make sure that that NHS that has done us so proud, and that social care service, that workforce that's done us so proud over this pandemic, is adequately supported, adequately resourced to do all the major catch-up we need so we find that missing 7,000 cancer care patients and we start the hard work of addressing the pandemic that's going to follow this one, which is a mental health pandemic. If the government is serious in that endeavour, we will work with them on it. We will welcome it when they get it right, we will challenge when we think they can go further, and we will expose it when it goes wrong. But start with a grown-up conversation and respect the people of Glasgow and beyond.
Thank you, Mr. Sawa. I now call on Julian Mackay to open for the Greens. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I welcome you to your new role as well. As is traditional with first speeches, I would like to take a few seconds to thank all who campaigned and voted for me, my wonderful family and partner, and for all their support. It's a privilege to be here representing Central Scotland and the wonderful diverse communities we have, and I look forward to engaging with as many of them as possible over the next 5 years. The past year has been one that no one in this building could have predicted. We've seen the best from our communities, both in my region and across the country. We've seen so much hardship, social isolation, the disproportionate effect it's had on disabled communities, and the unprecedented use of the word unprecedented. Presiding Officer, I want to put on the record, as the new Greens Health spokesperson, my deep and sincere thanks to all our health and social care workers across the country who have worked so hard for so long to protect lives and provide the care we need. We need to thank key workers from all sectors who've kept Scotland going throughout the pandemic. They deserve our gratitude, and I'm deeply thankful for everything they've done. The Scottish Greens are committing to ensuring that the health and care sector doesn't just recover as we emerge from the worst of the pandemic. We must take this opportunity to build back stronger and better services that have people at their heart. That means both patients and workers, the nurses, doctors, carers, pharmacists, porters, cleaners, and all those across all services. Clearly, part of this agenda is about fair pay. And if the pandemic has taught us anything, it's to value health and social care workers and the vital work they play. I'm proud that the Scottish Greens played their part earlier this year when we secured an additional £100 million investment into public sector pay. But fair pay, as we know, is only part of the story. We also need to radically improve working conditions. We've all heard of the toll that working in our NHS takes on staff, and we need to change this culture and give staff access to proper mental health support and counselling, as well as ensuring a work-life balance and progression opportunities that allow them to thrive. I also want to take this opportunity to give my condolences to all those who have lost loved ones and my sympathies to those who have suffered from COVID, and particularly those who are going to continue to suffer from long COVID. Long COVID will be with us for a time to come, and appropriate support and staff need to be put in place to give patients the best support. We do not yet fully understand the wide-ranging and complex nature of long COVID and how long many of the symptoms being experienced will persist. Investing in research and multidisciplinary treatment should be a minimum to make sure that no one is left behind. While there is cause for hope with the vaccine rollout and current lower prevalence, we still have a way to go before some form of normality can resume. I would like to take this opportunity to encourage everybody under 30 to make sure they've registered for their JAG and that everyone takes their appointment once it is sent to them. I'd also like to take this opportunity to encourage employers to make sure that their employees are available for their vaccines if they are during work time. Getting your JAG is not just about protecting yourself. It's about protecting everyone. So go online, book your appointment, and roll up your sleeve. As we continue our vital work, we must support recovery in the health service. That means the huge task of remobilising services and taking the opportunity to improve on the way we did things previously. Our staff have had a hard year, and they need our support when it comes to the backlog of needs. Measures like expanding the workforce and GP practices so that patients can get at least 15 minutes with their family doctor, and growing practice teams to include welfare rights officers and mental health clinicians. This would improve access to primary health care and support at a time when people might be put off a visit with the doctor. Restarting cancer screening and other health screening is a must, as well as ensuring that a cancer workforce plan is agreed so that services can meet patient demand. Mental health is another area that was lacking pre-pandemic investment, but this is not just about treatment at the sharp end, and we need to end the current cycle of crisis management. We need to look upstream, expanding mental health support like talking therapies, as well as CBT, exercise referral schemes and peer support. Improving self-directed support and care is an issue that many of us heard repeatedly from disabled people during the election. Personally, one of the things I cannot wait to get involved in is the development of a national care service, and I look forward to working with the Cabinet Secretary for Health on that. However, while we wait for a national care service to become a reality, we should be ending the process of competitive tendering and investing in our dedicated workforce. A national care service is needed because caring is a national priority. It's a public need, and so must be a public service. Presiding Officer, the recovery of our health and wellbeing from COVID is about the ability of our communities to look after themselves and each other. From Airdrie to Motherwell to Falkirk, in the last year we've come together to keep each other safe from the virus. We need to harness that solidarity to support our health and care services going forward. Thank you.
And thank you to Gillian Mackay. I should have said that that was her first speech in our Parliament today, so well done. I would now like to call Alex Cole-Hamilton to open for the Lib Dems. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It gives me great pride to rise for the Liberal Democrats. And can I start by congratulating Gillian Mackay on an excellent speech, and indeed to extend good wishes to all those who have cause to make their first speech today. It has been evident for some time that this intake of new MSPs has brought with it a very welcome breadth of talent, and I wish them well. I look forward to working with them. Presiding Officer, shortly before New Year's Eve in 2019, Chinese public health officials first alerted the WHO to the human transmission of something that in the hospitals of Wuhan City they were referring to as animal pneumonia. Back then, it all seemed so far away. And in this chamber, in those early days, the principal concern that we had as members were those Scots who were in that part of China and their inability to leave it. And then suddenly it was here. I'll never forget that opposition briefing of at which the CMO and the Health Secretary appeared, ashen-faced, to tell us that the virus could no longer be contained and that our public health priority was now to protect our NHS from being overwhelmed. Schools and businesses would close, home working would become the new norm, and we would have to teach our children the meaning of the word lockdown. While the NHS mobilised, so too did our communities. And there we have seen humanity at its greatest. I'm sure that colleagues across the chamber will share my sentiment when I speak of the gratitude that we owe them. In my own constituency in Edinburgh Weston, local hospitality businesses delivered free meals to the vulnerable, and mutual aid groups made a colossal effort to ensure that vulnerable neighbours were not left isolated or without support. And while we should be proud of our communities, we should be doubly so of our care and our key workers. This nation owes them a debt that I don't think we can ever truly repay. But, Presiding Officer, in those weeks of high infection, amid those frantic efforts to prepare for an expected tsunami of COVID cases, part of those preparations undoubtedly led inadvertently to catastrophe. And when the histories of Scotland's pandemic are written, the tragedy of that story will be found in our care homes. The minutes of the Scottish Government's COVID advisory group of 2nd April cover several topics, but two points in particular stand out. Firstly, that our scientists were struggling to understand how the virus was moving around in Scottish hospitals despite infection control, and secondly, that it wanted to speed up the movement of elderly patients out of those same hospitals and into Scottish care homes. Presiding Officer, the international community had been screaming about asymptomatic viral transmission since January, yet the decision was taken to accelerate the movement of over 3,000 hospital patients whose COVID status was unknown and dozens who had even tested positive into care homes that were working desperately hard to keep residents safe and to find PPE. That put a time bomb in the heart of the most vulnerable communities in our country. And the response to outbreaks in our care homes was brutal in isolation and the misery of separation. Now, I don't blame any one person for those realities or those decisions, but it does underscore the need and the urgency for this government to commission an independent public inquiry without delay. That inquiry should not be about politics, but about a catharsis, about healing and learning for the remnants of this virus and any future pandemic that may visit on our shores. Presiding Officer, in that spirit, I do want to thank the government for their efforts to include opposition members in the pandemic response. Ministers and cabinet secretaries made themselves available and would respond swiftly, sometimes to individual cases of constituents that had been left behind or unfairly disadvantaged. I was gratified that when I raised the reality that Edinburgh Zoo was just weeks from permanent closure, if the government's timetable for reopening was not amended, that I was taken seriously and they were given the latitude that they needed. And again, when I raised, along with Monica Lennon, the plight of new parents who had spent their pregnancies shielding and were now adrift of support networks, they were granted permission by this government to visit with each other indoors. Those exchanges showed what this Parliament can accomplish through consensus, and we're going to need much more of that. For the wedding and events industry, who still lack clarity about how the easing of restrictions will allow their industries to come back to profit. To those with additional support needs, who are still prevented from accessing long and short stay respite services. And for the young people who did not expect to have to sit life qualifying exams, but now face a diet of assessments without a clear appeals process. Presiding officer, we often talk about life before the pandemic. Before we were confined to our homes, when we could hug our loved ones and could go to the pub with as many of them as we chose. But aspiring to get back to life before the pandemic is a low bar to set, because before the pandemic, students from our poorest communities were still being failed by a system that is widening the attainment gap. Our communities were still being torn apart by the drug deaths emergency, the worst in the developed world. And children suffering from mental ill health faced the longest queue in our National Health Service. We need to put recovery first. And that starts with recognising that this pandemic is far from over. This morning I had cause to speak to the head teacher of Davidson's Mains Primary School in my constituency for the second time in as many days, and since the outbreak of COVID closed her school on Tuesday. All told, 12 classes are now isolating and community transmission is surging. I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to reassure my community in his closing remarks that this outbreak commands the full attention of his government. Presiding officer, the first debates of a new parliamentary term strike a very different tone than those debates we were used to in the closing days of the last session. The eyes of the country are now fixed to this chamber in anticipation and in expectation. And the measure of our success in living up to that expectation will be assessed in how we build consensus, how quickly we respond to emerging areas of greatest need, and how we resist the divisions of the past. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. I now move to backbenchers' contributions. And I would remind members that the contribution should be of 6 minutes, if possible. And I would first call Neil Gray, who is making his first speech in our Parliament today. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure and an honour to be making my first speech in Scotland's National Parliament, and to be doing so with you in the chair for the first time as well. Congratulations. But also to be doing so addressing the most pressing issue facing us all right now, not just here in Scotland, but around the world. And so I welcome and congratulate John Swinney on his new role. His cross-departmental responsibility in leading our COVID recovery is of critical importance, and he's ideally suited to bringing together all areas of government towards our best recovery. And I also welcome Hamza Youssef to his new position as Health Secretary. I'm pleased to see what my friend has achieved since we both started as staffers many moons ago. And I wish him well in following the fantastic contribution from Jean Freeman, who I also thank for her incredible service. It'll come as no surprise to the new Health Secretary that I will be in regular contact about the new Monklands Hospital, as I was in the same way with Jean Freeman. And like Mr. Youssef, I am also seeking to follow a very successful predecessor, and I would like to take this opportunity to wish Alec Neil well for his retirement. Although he has retired from this place, I suspect he won't be searching for his pipe and slippers just yet. He has given an immense service to his constituents over 22 years as a member of the Scottish Parliament and our nation as a minister over 7 years. I thank him for his friendship and support, and I'm sure colleagues will join me in wishing him well for his retirement. Before I move on, I would like to thank my family and for their fantastic support, and my campaign team, led by my agent Graham Russell, for their phenomenal efforts. I wouldn't be here without all of them. This has been a year like no other. It's been hard for people in so many ways, missing family and friends, missing events, missing our normal way of life, and of course missing those who have been lost. COVID has robbed us of our ability to live our lives, to mourn those who have lost their lives, and to support those who have found their lives in lockdown most difficult. So I want to put on record my thanks to those who continue to work, either paid or voluntarily, to keep services going, to keep support in place, to keep people in touch. And in Adrian Schott's there were so many shining examples of groups doing what they could to help others. Organisations like the Shotts Healthy Living Centre, Airdrie Food Bank, Paul's Parcels, Hope for Autism, Diamonds in the Community, Crawford's Pharmacy, Airdrie Action Partnership, the Salvation Army, to name just a few, but also our public sector workers, our teachers, social workers, police, and of course our fantastic NHS staff, who have all had to adapt to very difficult circumstances, but who all responded and who should be thanked by us all. And thanks to the perseverance and sacrifices of people across Scotland and the incredibly successful vaccination programme, we are now hopefully getting closer to a route back to normality. But it was a difficult journey, and there will be a lot of work required to get us back, not just to where we were pre-lockdown, but to take us even further forward. And linked to that, from a business perspective, I have a question I hope the Health Secretary may be able to answer in closing. Businesses have had a really difficult time of it during this crisis, and while I thank the government for the support packages that they have made available, there is clearly a desire for them to be able to return to normality as quickly as it is safe for them to do so. Close contact businesses, particularly beauty therapy businesses in Airdrie and Shotts, have been in touch with me about the rules around face masks. And I know the restrictions on treatments and the requirement for face masks is under review, and obviously acknowledge the need to make sure people are kept safe. But I know many local businesses would appreciate any updates that the Minister may have on when this may be relaxed. And in terms of recovery, I am pleased to see the NHS recovery plan and significant investment to match it to help us catch up with delayed operations and referrals. The time and services that will be required to support people who have suffered a deterioration in their mental health during lockdown will also be substantial. So the coming 100 days and beyond will be so important, and I'm glad such an emphasis has been placed on continuing to suppress the virus and building a recovery for our NHS and society that works for everybody. The work to identify and deliver opportunities for our young people, maintaining our focus to tackle the climate emergency and achieve our net zero targets, investing in schools and teaching staff, and of course continuing to do what we can with the powers available to us to eradicate child poverty, none of those issues should be partisan. And I hope, following the statement from the First Minister yesterday and reiterated by Mr Swinney today, we can go back to the founding principles of this re-established Parliament and seek to find consensus on these critical issues. The people of Scotland returned the SNP to government and did so by a wide margin and by any measure of success. But they also did so as to expect us as political leaders to work together as best we can. And even on the issue of a second referendum that this government has a mandate to deliver, I accept some parties here do not want to happen. But they fought an election opposed to a referendum, while the SNP and the Greens stood in the manifestos committed to a referendum. There is no doubt which side won. So at the very least, there should be an acceptance across the chamber that the referendum will happen when it is safe for it to do so, and save the debate for whether Scotland should be independent or not, and of course where the powers should lie to dictate our economic recovery. So to conclude, Madam Deputy Presiding Officer, I wish to thank the people of Airdrie and Shotts for entrusting me with the honour and responsibility of representing them in Scotland's National Parliament. I will do so to the best of my ability, regardless or if they voted at all, and I look forward to working with colleagues across the chamber to support the work of the Scottish Government in delivering the ambitious programme to see us building a fairer and more socially just Scotland.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr Gray. I would next call Stephen Kerr, also making his first speech in our Parliament today, and he will be followed by Stuart McMillan. Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and congratulations on your debut in the chair, and congratulations to Neil Gray, who I look forward to renewing our debates again in this Parliament. It is a real privilege to be able to stand and speak in my first debate as a member of the Scottish Parliament. I'm honoured to represent Central Scotland. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, this is not the first time that I have spoken in the Scottish Parliament. On May the 2nd, 2001, representing my church, I offered time for reflection. The 2001 census had just taken place, and I spoke about the preciousness of every living person and the loving ties that bind us together as the family of humanity. And on that occasion, I offered a prayer, asking God to bless our dear land with healing, love, and unity. And I also prayed for those who sit in Scotland's Parliament, that they may be filled with the spirit of fairness, understanding and wisdom. Now, those words from 20 years ago pretty much sum up how I feel today making my first speech in this Parliament. Scotland's people stand in need of healing, love and unity. And we, the parliamentarians of the sixth session of the Scottish Parliament, stand in need of an endowment of the spirit of fairness, understanding and wisdom. I said in my maiden speech in Scotland's other parliament that I believe that we have a duty as parliamentarians to personify civility. And although we will disagree with one another from time to time, we ought not to be disagreeable. Presiding officer, members of the Scottish Parliament have a solemn duty to hold the Scottish Government to account. And in the spirit of that duty, I have several questions to ask the Cabinet Secretary, who will reply to this debate. The vaccines are a modern-day miracle, a miracle of science. I had my second vaccination on Monday this week, and I'm very grateful for it. We have known from the very beginning of the vaccine rollout that we were in a race against this deadly virus. And everything which can be done must be done at speed to get vaccines into arms. Yet, the Cabinet Secretary for Health was reported earlier this week as saying, "I think there is room in the coming weeks to increase the number of vaccines that we are administering every day, every week." Will the Cabinet Secretary explain to Parliament why the vaccine rollout was not being, and I'll use his word, maximised already? What was being held back? What is he going to do now that should have been done weeks ago to maximise the rollout? The Cabinet Secretary was asked about how long it will take to get the performance of the NHS in Scotland back to pre-pandemic levels. And he replied, "Look, I won't lie to you. It's going to take years." And I accept the Cabinet Secretary's words at face value. He says the recovery of our NHS services in Scotland is going to take years. He also says he's going to put political differences aside to focus a national effort on the remobilisation and recovery of the NHS. Well, presiding officer, we will judge the Cabinet Secretary by his own words. Will he really, in his own words, put aside political differences, set aside his party's constitutional obsessions, such as we heard again yesterday from the First Minister when she made her statement? Will this government genuinely put the national interest first? Because it's going to take years for the NHS to recover. And when such a crucial matter as the recovery of NHS services in Scotland is still in the balance, we must work together rather than be pulled apart. We are winning the war against this virus, at least in our own little corner of the world, thanks to the vaccines and the far-sightedness of the UK government in procuring the quantities of the vaccines they did. I would say to the Chamber that I believe that the time has come for us to reassess how we measure the impact of this virus so that we can begin to fully restore our freedoms and our way of life. When we started down this path over a year ago, it was to prevent the NHS from being overwhelmed. Let's get back to measuring our actions against that objective. Presiding officer, I hope that the SNP Scottish Government will be serious about working cooperatively to tackle the serious challenges that lie ahead of us. I hope that they will set aside their default ideological positions and work together with the British Government in order to tackle these serious challenges. In survey after survey, the people of Scotland want their two governments to work together now as never before. And the question is, are the SNP Scottish Government listening to the people of Scotland.
I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Pam Duncan-Clancy.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And at the outset, I'd like to congratulate you on your election as Presiding Officer and wish you well in the role. I'd like to thank the electorate of Greenock and Inverclyde for once again putting their trust in me to represent them in our nation's Parliament. It's a huge honour and privilege, and it's one that I never have or will take for granted. I represent a constituency with hard-working and fine people, and also with areas of some stunning beauty and potential for greater growth in tourism and also economic output, and I represent the best constituency in the country. Notwithstanding the many positive constituency issues that my area has, there are some challenges that we do face, and COVID-19 has highlighted some of them. The recovery from COVID is crucial to help aid and also assist many people in Greenock and Inverclyde. COVID-19 has been involved in 215 deaths in Inverclyde. Too many families and friends will still be feeling the loss of their loved ones, and in my community, which really is like a big village, that loss still resonates. And early in the pandemic, we had the highest level of deaths than any other local authority area. And some of the media, and also elsewhere, used a catchy, headline-grabbing soundbite that I never used it, and every time I did hear it, it angered me. And I know certainly that many people in my community were angered by it also. It was crass and also insensitive, and it paid lip service to those who actually had died because of COVID. The title, sadly, is still being used, but it's been passed on to other local authorities now. I want to pay tribute to everyone in Inverclyde who has played their part in helping our community as well as we have been on that awful COVID journey. Every public sector worker, every third sector worker, every private sector worker, and every volunteer who has played their part, thank you. Their efforts have not been unnoticed, and they deserve every single plaudit for how they have helped turn our community round. As we heard from the First Minister yesterday and many times before, the recovery from COVID is the priority, and that's what the electorate want. Now, irrespective as to which portfolio areas that we consider, whether it's health, the economy, environment, the local government, education, transport, there are examples where the recovery must and will aid every community in the country. Now, I want to focus on two at this particular point, and that's health and also the economy. The average 4% pay increase to our valued NHS staff is welcomed, and backdating at the payment to December is also the right thing to do. And I know that my constituents have valued the efforts of our NHS during the COVID pandemic. Abolishing the dental charges is the right thing to do, and I welcome this also. Scotland has long had an unenviable record when it's come to oral health and hygiene. And although great strides have been made, this first step to remove the dental charges for care leavers will actually continue that improvement. An increase in the mental health spend by at least 20% will be hugely important, as we know COVID has been challenging for many more people. I would hope that the additional investment will also be used for third sector organisations like Mind Mosaic and Safe Harbour in my constituency, who both do outstanding work helping people rebuild their lives. And the SNP manifesto, a commitment to invest £10 billion in the NHS estate was welcomed, and certainly will be even more so when investment starts in my local hospital, the Inverclyde Royal Hospital, the IRH. I want to see a new built hospital, and I know that consideration for that particular idea is growing in the community. However, until such times as that happens, the IRH does need substantial investment. It's a discussion I regularly have with the Health Board and have certainly raised it with the Scottish Government in the past as well. It's not the only major building project that we need, but it's certainly the most highly charged one when it comes to the local community. And a building of that size with a flat roof at the top of a hill with no shelter nearby in Greenock was just a ridiculous decision at that time when it was built in the 1970s. The hospital has served our community well, but it now needs that substantial investment. In addition, I've already written to the Health Board seeking a meeting about the range of services that are at the hospital and also the long-term strategy for the community. And finally, on health, the creation of a national care service will be an outstanding achievement when it's delivered. I would encourage both the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care and also the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care to visit the Holy Rosary residents in Greenock to witness for themselves an exemplar in facilities and what actually can be achieved. When Shona Robeson was the Cabinet Secretary for Health, she visited and was genuinely hugely impressed by what she saw. Now, the economy matters,
and I welcome the creation of a new Council for Economic Transformation. It's abundantly clear that although we want things to improve, we can't have society go back to the way that it was. A fairer, just and greener economy is essential to improving the lives of many, many more people and also communities. And my area now has the lowest SIMD location in the country, in addition to a growing older population as well as a declining population. We've had a declining population for some 40 years. We want to be net contributors to the country, and recovery from COVID must be seen as an opportunity to build a stronger Inverclyde and a stronger Scotland. Now, part of this clearly involved increasing our exports, which makes the comments and the letter from Stephen Kerr to the UK government even more ridiculous. Having offices elsewhere actually is a chance to engage and highlight what Scotland actually has to offer at a time, instead of part of the time that the UK government actually undertake. Having full-time operations elsewhere is a benefit to Scotland. And I'm sure that Baron Duncan of Springbank, the Conservative Deputy Speaker of the House of Lords, will actually agree to that. Now, if anyone doesn't know, Baron Duncan was Ian Duncan. He was then the Scottish Parliament's officer in Brussels, helping the Scottish Parliament and all parliamentarians engage with the EU. Presiding officer, recovery from COVID must be and is a priority, and then we can move forward to having a referendum when it's safe to do so, to make our country the country we want it to be. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Pam Duncan-Clancy to be followed by Maggie Chapman. This is Ms Duncan-Clancy's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And if you will, for a moment, indulge me in what is a lifetime of thank yous. Starting, of course, with my family, my friends, my husband and the dog, who I think wonders where I am most days. Just over 3 weeks ago, I was working full-time in the NHS by day, and by night I was campaigning on the streets of Glasgow, come rain or shine, or rather, come rain or hail. All I asked for was the opportunity to serve. Today, I sit before all of you because the people of Glasgow took a leap of faith and took their place in the history books by making this one of the most diverse parliaments in the world. So to you all, thank you. From the bottom of my heart, for the opportunity to serve. I promise that for as long as I am here, none of you are on your own. Thank you too to the Labour Party, to the people who sat on these benches directly before me, James Kelly and Joanne Lamont, for their service to Glasgow and this Parliament. To my party colleagues in this chamber and my comrades across the Labour movement, never underestimate what you did. A wee working class girl in a wheelchair grew up to be a wee working class MSP in a wheelchair. Thank you. As we start this journey in Holyrood, I reflect that it is a journey that people across Scotland, from all parts of our nation and people in this chamber, have played a part. I did not build my life alone. No one can and no one ever should. I grew up with a family who loved and pushed me hard, and in my formative years I had a Labour government that had my back. It was a government that valued diversity, that introduced laws like the Human Rights Act, the Equality Act and the Civil Partnership Act, a government that lifted people out of poverty. That's what a Labour government did, and I know that my colleagues on these benches and I will do everything we can to work across this chamber with anyone who is willing to work with us to make such big and bold change again, to protect the interests of ordinary people like us, and to use this Parliament and its powers to change the world. I want to pay tribute to the disability movement too. The fights we have won for disabled people's rights throughout this history have led to this moment. I promise that for as long as I am in this place, your fight will be my fight. There will be nothing about us without us. Presiding Officer, She's a Fighter was not just the slogan of my campaign. It's the story of my life, but sadly, the story of far too many people's lives. This last year has been tough for all of us. The pandemic separated us from our friends and our family, but despite that, we come together like never before. The truth is, though, that for too many people, things were impossibly hard before COVID. Poverty was rife, insecure and precarious work was too common, social care was creaking at the seams, and inequality was holding people back. In Glasgow, people have been doing their best and struggling to make ends meet for years. They've been working longer hours, taking less home and turning to food banks for years. They've needed more affordable homes, a crackdown on unscrupulous landlords, and a pay rise for years. Disabled people across Scotland have been living below the poverty line, having their care packages cut, and they've been dragging themselves upstairs because there aren't enough accessible homes for years. Things were bad before COVID, but the pandemic has made them worse. We cannot go back to that normal. We have to go forward to better. A Scotland where social care is free at the point of delivery, where human rights and equality are enshrined in law and practised in reality. A Scotland where trans people are valued and accepted for who they are, where people who use drugs get the support they need, not a criminal record. A Scotland where no young person grows up in poverty. A Scotland with a social security system that's there for people in and out of work and that guarantees a minimum income. That's the new normal we need, and that's the new normal we across this chamber must seek to deliver. I'm delighted to have been asked by Anna Sarwar to lead for Scottish Labour on social security as part of that transformation now. And I'm pleased to put a fighter in the role, because in a matter of days in the Parliament, we can see we're going to need one. This Parliament has only just met, and in the last 2 weeks, and while we've had an upgrade in social security powers, we've had a downgrade in its attention. Colleagues, the road ahead is hard, so the fight for a better future is real, and it's going to need grit and guts to get us there. So I say to all the people of Scotland who need ours to be a country where social security is bold, where we go hard and go fast to end poverty and inequality, and to Nas, who trusted me with this, I will not waste a second in this place to fight to make that happen. At a time when 1 million people are in poverty, half of households in poverty have a disabled person in them, 400,000 people earn below the living wage, 83,000 people are on 0 hours contracts, and over 200,000 people are going to food banks. We need a social security system that uses all the powers we have here in Scotland to ensure no one is held back by poverty or inequality. Presiding officer, we cannot come through the collective trauma of COVID and go back to normal. We must focus on solutions that build a better Scotland. That starts with making the vaccine rollout a national priority. It means acting now to prevent unfair evictions. Businesses need more support too. And we need an effective recovery plan for vital retail and creative sectors. And while social care staff have been on the front line, risking their lives to save ours, and I thank those who have worked with me all through this year to support me in my life, they need an immediate pay rise too, to £12 an hour, with a further increase to £15 an hour as soon as possible. Presiding officer, in this Parliament we have a big job to do. But that comes with a big responsibility and a big opportunity to rise to that challenge. I have hope. I have hope because for too long this Parliament and others like it have not looked like the people they're here to represent. But this year is different. The people of Scotland broke glass ceilings and glass staircases. This room got a bit closer to looking a bit more like the people of Scotland. It's now our chance to turn a little hope into lasting change. This is the room where it happens. So to all the disabled children out there, to anyone who's ever felt left out or left behind, I'm here for you, and as long as I'm here, you will be here with me. I will fight for you, like our lives depend on it. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Paul McLennan. This is Ms. Chapman's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and welcome to your new role too. COVID is one of the greatest challenges of our time. It has transformed our lives. Over 1,000 lives have been lost in northeast Scotland alone, the region I have the huge honour and privilege of representing, and I want to remember them all now. But the pandemic is not some kind of accident. It is not a natural disaster that could not have been prevented. It is the result of a series of choices and a specific set of circumstances. To understand what we need to do to avoid another disaster of this type, we must look at what caused it. We need to examine how a virus came to leap the species barrier and how that then moved from a local outbreak to a global pandemic. That chain of events is the result of a now dominant economic model that emerged in the 1970s. A model that seeks to drive free market relations into every interaction of our lives. A model that, as the northeast of Scotland knows only too well, doesn't care about the impacts of boom and bust. And a model that has, at its core, a number of assumptions. That the market is the ideal way of making decisions. That the economy is more important than other things, like our health. That the poor must be punished if they don't work, while bosses must be incentivized to work. That the state should play a minimal role in our society. That inequality is a good thing because it increases the power of the wealthy. In short, that chain of events is the result of neoliberalism. The intensive extraction of value from nature, turning wild animals into profit by harvesting and selling them in a wet market, created the conditions for the virus to leap the species boundary. The global circulation of the rich, alongside the global circulation of capital, both functions of neoliberalism, turns a virus jumping the species barrier from a localized outbreak into a global pandemic. And we have seen repeatedly how neoliberalism has deepened the COVID crisis. Westminster's idolizing of the market meant a delay to lockdown at the cost of thousands of lives. Ironically, this delay also meant the economy suffered. Countries which locked down early and effectively avoided long, repeated lockdowns, avoiding economic damage. The lives of thousands who died were sacrificed to neoliberalism, a system that was wrong, is wrong, and will continue to be wrong however many more lives we sacrifice to it. Letting the bodies pile high in their thousands isn't a colourful turn of phrase. It is at the core of what the Prime Minister believes. We have all seen this week just how deeply dangerous this commitment is. The UK government's planning for pandemics was reduced to buying body bags. They wasted billions of pounds on an eat-out-to-help-out scheme that helped stoke a second wave. They briefed that workers had to go back to the office or face the sack. At the DVLA, this led to the worst COVID outbreak in the UK, at the order of a UK minister, because workers must be punished to make them work. Had money for better sick pay been made available, workers with symptoms could have self-isolated. Westminster spent £37 billion, close to our government's annual budget, on a catastrophically ineffective test and trace system for England and Wales. COVID cronyism saw the UK government funnel public money to their pals. The British state is clearly broken. Where Scotland took a different path, like on test and trace, we benefited from the willingness to go our own way. So, what is to be done? We know that the countries that did best at dealing with COVID are those that are the most equal, those that value the lives of their citizens above narrow short-term economic gain. We know that the impact of COVID has been so much worse for those, such as BAME people, who already suffer inequality. So we need to use all of our powers to create a more equal society. And we need to acquire the powers that we don't already have to create that more equal society more quickly. We urgently need to increase social solidarity. We need to take back power and planning from the market. And that is why the Scottish Greens will work with citizens, civil society, institutions, other political parties to identify the risks that face us, from pandemics to climate breakdown. Take these risks seriously and put in place the measures needed to do what the market simply cannot. Protect our citizens from these risks, from the risks of an ever more unstable world. We must make a state that treats its citizens with care and not accept the neoliberal ideology that allows the bodies to pile high in their thousands. Because we know we face a global crisis that will make COVID look like a walk in the park. We have to act now. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Paul McLennan to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Presiding Officer, thank you, and can I add my congratulations to you on your appointment. I'm delighted, honoured and humbled to be able to give my first speech as the first SNP MSP for East Lothian. I want to thank my family and my fantastic campaign team. 3 weeks ago, like many of us today on the 6th of May, I watched people queue to vote all over East Lothian. People queuing because they believe in our democracy. People queuing because they believed in our ability to make things better for them. And people queuing because they trust us to change their lives for the better. What an honour that is. All this at the time where every single person has been affected by COVID, where almost overnight our lives were turned upside down. Many losing loved ones, losing their livelihood and losing hope. I wish to thank all key workers for their amazing efforts over the past 14 months. I'm honoured and humbled to represent the constituency of East Lothian, where I've lived all my life. The constituency where the Saltire was born in 832 in Elshinford. The constituency of the Bass Rock, and of course, the birthplace of John Muir in my hometown of Dunbar. And our latest addition is the Dunbar, a statue which is there to honour John Muir. This is also located in Dunbar and was designed by Andy Scott, designer of the Kelpies. East Lothian is like Scotland in many ways. It's a mix of rural and urban communities. It has its areas of prosperity, but there are areas of which are included in the most deprived parts of Scotland. My predecessor, Ian Gray, in his final speech said that East Lothian was the best constituency, best county and best part of Scotland in which to live or work. Of course, I concur with his comments, but I'm obviously biased. I want to say thank you to Ian for being MSP for East Lothian for 14 years and for his commitment to the county and its well-being, which was unquestionable. We also share a passion for Hibernian Football Club, a harrowing experience at the best of times, especially over the last weekend, and I've been reminded by that by some St Johnstone fans over the weekend. So, Ian, I wish you and your family well. COVID-19 has impacted in every element in life in East Lothian, be that in our schools, in our hospitals, in our fishing and farming communities, our tourist attractions and on our high streets. I welcome the recent announcement of the Scottish Government's 100 days priorities. I welcome the cross-party group on COVID recovery. And I've already reached out to councillors in East Lothian to work with me. Specifically on health, completing the vaccination programme is our priority. It has to be our priority. On the NHS recovery plan, I look forward to meeting NHS Lothian to discuss the specifics for East Lothian around about the 10% promised increase in activities, including additional services at the East Lothian Community Hospital. And I pledge to work with mental health practitioners as a matter of urgency as we continue to climb out of the pandemic. On education, I welcome the initial commitment to 1,000 new teachers and 500 classroom assistants, and of course the summer programmes to support recovery in our education system. The commitment to fund 5,000 short-term industry-related college courses is of course again very welcome. I look forward to discussing these with education colleagues in East Lothian. On our economy, I welcome the introduction for the Council for Economic Transformation. I aim to replicate that locally as well in East Lothian. Additional funding for local partnerships and for the Youth Guarantee Scheme will be vitally important to young people in the county. Tourism is a big part of our economy in East Lothian as well. It employs 5,000 people and generates £260 million annually to our economy. The Tourism Recovery Fund, I know, was very welcome. Our town centres not only employ many people also, but they are the beating hearts of our communities. I look forward to continue working with local traders in East Lothian, who have engaged fully with the Scotland Loves local message. Our traders do our county proud. And in tackling poverty, as we recover from the pandemic, the Scottish Government pledge to support low-income families is very welcome. I pledge to work with anti-poverty groups across East Lothian to tackle this issue as urgently as we can. And moving out of COVID, we have opportunities. Martin Luther King said, "The time is always right to do what is right." The time is right to address our climate challenge and make changes to our economy with well-being at its core. The time is right to build in the sense of community which we have seen all over Scotland. And the time is right to work together whenever we can to give our communities that sense of hope, trust and belief in us that made them turn out in record numbers 3 weeks ago. Presiding officer, I want to close with another quote, this time from John Muir. "The power of imagination is infinite. Let's all endeavour to work together to make that power of imagination change lives in Scotland."
Thank you. Thank you. Of course, that was Mr McLennan's first speech in this chamber. I now call Sandesh Gulhani to be followed by John Mason, and this is Dr Gulhani's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you. Glasgow elected me, but I'm also here to represent the Scottish NHS, my patients, my colleagues, to make them feel like they truly have a voice. I want to be the strongest advocate for our Scottish Health Service. Today, I'm going to give voice to some of the most urgent issues facing our health service. These are issues that need to be dealt with today. It is imperative to the future health of our nation. It is about rebuilding and recovering recovering from staff burnout, rebuilding strategies to deal with burgeoning waiting lists, and helping those directly affected by COVID. But why should you listen to me rather than the health ministers who have spoken here in the past? Well, I was born to immigrant parents from India. They came here with nothing, but through hard work and sacrifice, they educated me. I began life as a doctor in 2006, and like all junior doctors, I moved regularly from London to Birmingham to Wolverhampton to Sunderland to Glasgow. And it is here in Glasgow I found a home, a family, a community. I am a frontline doctor, having worked in accident and emergency, out of hours, and seeing patients in general practice. As the pandemic struck, I did what thousands of other Scottish healthcare workers did. I kept seeing my patients. The brightest lights shine only in the darkest skies. And during the pandemic, I have seen the bravery and humanity of my colleagues shine very brightly indeed. But I had low points too. When my lockdown baby was born, I stayed away because of the fear of passing COVID to her. I did not hug her for 8 weeks. My newborn baby. But I kept seeing my patients. I kept my distance from my 7-year-old son because of the fear of passing COVID to him. And one day he asked my wife why I didn't love him anymore. Had he done something wrong? But like my nursing colleagues, I kept seeing my patients. The Scottish Government sent me out PPE that put my life at risk. But like the hospital physios, porters and occupational therapists, I kept seeing my patients. Until I realised I could no longer say nothing. I could no longer feel nothing. I could no longer do nothing. I stood for election to voice the pain of my patients, to voice the burnout of my colleagues, to voice everyone's desperate wish for us to work together. So that's why. But who needs help? Well, imagine a teenage boy doing well at school, happy, has friends, and then one day COVID came along and stole everything. He is unable to leave his house. He can't bring himself to eat, but he faces a 52-week wait for assessment. He needs our help. Imagine a man coming up to retirement, happy, content. He's got savings, a job he loves. But then one day, COVID came along and stole everything. He became depressed. He tried to commit suicide. He needs our help. But you don't need to imagine this. This is the reality of my daily medical practice. This is our shared reality in Scotland. We stand on the precipice of a tsunami of a mental health crisis. We need to spend our money wisely, and I can help here. Imagine a single mum, fit and well, worked all her life, bought her dream house, but then one day COVID came along and stole everything. She had to move in with her parents to look after her kids. She had nowhere to turn for her long COVID. She needs our help. Imagine a doctor, a GP, happy and fit, but then one day COVID came along and stole everything. She cannot talk on the phone without being breathless. She cannot work as a GP all day due to brain fog and fatigue. She has lost her job. She has nowhere to turn for her long COVID. She needs our help. Long COVID affects 10 to 35% of people who contract COVID. That's 60 to 210,000 people. You don't need to imagine this. This is our patients' reality. They suffer from fatigue, breathlessness, heart failures, mental health problems, and much more. They are our workers who will turn our economy around. They are our doctors and nurses, our supermarket staff. They are dock workers and teachers and bus drivers. They are your kids, your brother, your sisters, your parents, your grandparents. They are you and me. But we are not funding their help here in Scotland. England have set up bespoke clinics with new money. We, well, there is no new money, but models exist that work. We need the Scottish Government to help, to care, to fund these clinics. Over the coming months and years, I will stand here and advocate for real change, real help, for real people. And I don't care what party you represent. If you want the same as me, rebuild and recover from the pandemic, I will work with you. It has been said, he who has health has hope, and he who has hope has everything. So I implore the Cabinet Secretary for Health to give the people hope again, and I will work with all of you for a brighter, healthier future for Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I call John Mason to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I congratulate Sandesh Gulhani on his opening speech. And firstly, I think there are so many people that we need to be grateful to for bringing us through this pandemic so far. Clearly, there's the NHS and many other carers and key workers. And particularly, we should be grateful to those around the world who have worked in inventing and producing vaccines. We're very fortunate in Scotland and the UK to have rolled out so quickly, when I think only Israel has been significantly ahead of us. We can obviously mention political leaders like Nicola Sturgeon, but particularly too, I would want to mention Jean Freeman as the previous Health Secretary and all the work that she did. Having previously been on the COVID committee in Parliament, experts like Jason Leach and Linda Bald were incredibly helpful too. It's very easy to look back and think better decisions could have been made, perhaps especially in the light of Dominic Cummings' statements yesterday. The UK government eat out to help out scheme last summer was probably wrong. I confess I was keen on it at the time. I had a meal out as often as I could in order to help local businesses both in Glasgow and when I was on holiday in Galloway and around Ullapool when I had a few days break. But looking back on it, encouraging people to gather indoors may not have been the best idea. However, I accept that that, amongst other ideas, was done with good intentions when we thought things were improving. So I don't think we should be going back and blaming the Chancellor for that. We have to cut people a bit of slack when we have the benefit of hindsight. Another decision which has been and will be questioned is whether we should have left elderly and vulnerable people in hospital or moved them out as was done. At the time, many of us thought hospital was a very risky place to be. Historically, infections have spread around hospitals rapidly, and we saw pictures of overflowing hospitals in Italy. So I certainly thought it was the right decision to move people out of hospital as fast as possible, even if there were some risks attached to that. I suspect we had fewer deaths than if people had remained in hospital, but it is still desperately sad that so many people died. Whether schools should have been open or closed and how exams should have been dealt with has also been contentious. One of the most vociferous lobby groups who contacted me, certainly, were certain parents who felt the schools should have been kept open all the time. And the question of exams or teacher assessments was a lose-lose situation. Whatever decision had been made would have been criticised. It remains my belief that we want a consistent standard of testing across the country, and we have to use national exams. Teacher assessments may sound good in theory, but inevitably you lose consistency and comparability. Some teachers will be optimistic for their pupils, other teachers will be pessimistic. Some will be stricter in assessing, others will be more lenient. So I believe we have to return to national exams as soon as we possibly can. Moving on to the economic side of things, the UK and most European countries have borrowed heavily to pay for furlough and other business support schemes, as well as extra spending on health and other services. So the UK is now very heavily in debt, to the level of some £2.1 trillion or £30,000 per head. That is not unmanageable, but we cannot keep borrowing at this rate. Interest rates are low at the moment, but that may or may not continue. And at some point, this debt has to be reduced and repaid. So both the UK and Scotland will have to make some difficult choices in the future. Do we raise taxes or do we reduce spending? Many organisations and individuals have done very well through COVID, and they could afford to pay more tax right now. However, others have clearly not done well, and with the ending of the furlough scheme, the economy may well take a turn for the worse. Company failures were lower than normal last year, so some companies may still be existing who would have gone bust in a normal year. I accept that many feel this is not the right time to raise taxes, but at some point we will have to consider this. If I can move on to the Glasgow situation, perhaps it is inevitable that cities will be hotspots for the virus. It was understandable but incredibly disappointing that Glasgow was left in level 3 when the rest of the country moved to level 2. Hopefully this will not be the case too much longer, but I do feel there's less willingness to follow the guidance as times go by. People are travelling into Glasgow to shop and to eat out. And I confess that last Saturday I was faced with the dilemma of whether or not to attend the demonstration against McVitie's closure. I wanted to attend and show support for factory staff, but that meant going against the advice and the guidelines. So in the end, I did decide to break the rules and to attend the demonstration. But others have been faced with much more difficult choices than I was. The sooner we can reach a place where the number of infections is acceptable, the better. In Amnesty's briefing for today, they raised the concern about human rights being curtailed during the pandemic. Constituents have raised this with me as well, the right to visit care homes, the right to attend a place of worship, and so on. These are all incredibly important in normal times, but we have not been in normal times, and I think it was inevitable that some human rights had to be temporarily curtailed. Of course, such curtailment must always be kept to a minimum, but we must always remember that the exercise of my rights may lead to someone else's life being impacted. So in that regard, I was a little disappointed that some of the churches went to court to get restrictions on them lifted. Hopefully this will not set a precedent for more court action by more groups if we have a similar situation in future. And finally, if I can just mention the rest of the world, there is always a danger that we get too focused on Scotland and the UK. By world standards, we have gotten incredibly well with vaccinations. I think some 35% have had both doses. But many countries, and especially poorer countries, are nowhere near us in giving their populations a jab. India is around 11%, Nepal 7%, to mention two in Asia. And in Africa, it's even worse. Uganda, 0.005%, Congo, 0.02%. I know our primary responsibility is for this country, and most people are desperate to get their jab, but please do let us not forget those countries which are not as rich and fortunate as we are. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Michelle Thompson. This is Ms Gallagher's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. From working at home to transforming the relationships we have with family and friends, COVID-19 has changed our lives. As my first speech to the Scottish Parliament, I would like to put on record my thanks to each and every frontline worker who made sacrifices in order to keep us safe and our country moving during the most difficult of times. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank those who helped with my election campaign, voted for me in the Hamilton, Lark Hall and Stonehouse constituency, and for the Scottish Conservatives on the Peach ballot paper to stop an SNP majority. I am honoured to be here as a newly elected MSP for Central Scotland, but before I move on, I would like to pay tribute to Margaret Mitchell and Alison Harris for their service as they step down from their roles in frontline politics. Presiding Officer, to ensure that Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom recovers as quickly and as efficiently as possible, we must find a way to build back better together. This means people and jobs must be at the heart of every decision made in this chamber, not just in the first 100 days of this new parliamentary term. As a councillor in Motherwell, I have witnessed firsthand the incredible efforts made by local community groups during the pandemic. Although many have suffered losses due to the spread of COVID-19, the help and support shown by others makes me proud to be Scottish and British. It is a pride in my community which drives me as a person, and it is why I decided to enter the world of politics. And I know we are not out of the woods yet, but I am hopeful that the community spirit shown during the lockdown period will continue as we move into a post-pandemic world. But for me, politics is about community. Growing up in North Lanarkshire, I witnessed decades of SNP and Labour politicians who were never able to improve life expectancy, create positive destinations for our young people, or make a lasting impact where I lived. To put it bluntly, most politicians in my area were invisible. That's why I joined the Scottish Conservatives, not just because I believe that Scotland's place is within the United Kingdom, but because elected members should be there to help their community and champion decisions being made locally. My gran and papa were also passionate about helping their community. They both stood as Conservative candidates in local elections, and I still thank them to this day for encouraging me to get involved in politics. Although they are no longer with me, I hope I can do them proud and my family proud as I start my new adventure as an MSP. One of my key priorities during the election campaign was rebuilding Scotland, and it's the recovery phase that I would like to focus on today, Presiding Officer. We know that the spread of the new variants is always going to be a real concern, but we now must focus our efforts onto job creation and economic recovery. We know that an economic crisis is looming due to the strain of the pandemic has had on our country's finances. As stated by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, our economy may not return to pre-pandemic levels until 2024 at the earliest. Therefore, plans must be put in place now to protect and grow our nation. We cannot afford to end up with a lost COVID generation, with young people missing out on educational opportunities, university or college graduates unable to find work, businesses unable to reopen, and people who are unable to train in a new skill set if they have been made redundant. But for these issues to be addressed, we need a Scottish Government which is solely focused on Scotland's recovery as we rebuild from the pandemic. If the SNP are serious about Scotland's recovery, they will take another referendum off the table and focus on what matters to the people of Scotland. As we know, the economy will be key to securing the best possible recovery plan for Scotland. We need to see businesses back on their feet as soon as possible, as well as the government looking to the future to create jobs. Within our manifesto, the Scottish Conservatives pledged a skill grant every year for training and skills development aimed at those who are unemployed or facing redundancy. We need the SNP Scottish Government to back our plans to implement a rebuilding roadmap to reopen our economy sooner to protect jobs and businesses from the looming economic crisis. My party has also called for unlimited apprenticeships for Scotland's young people, a policy that I am passionate about. And although I am pushing 30 and will no longer be able to call myself a young person, as a Shadow Minister for Children and Young People, I want to ensure that no one leaves school without good job opportunities. When I left Bannock High School, I did not have a clear career path, and it was a real daunting experience. Although I went on to study politics at university, there was no support network in place, especially for a school located in an area of high deprivation. I believe it is our responsibility as MSPs to make sure we implement policies to provide young people with the tools that they need to succeed in life. We need to build a future where our young people do not need to worry about their mental health and that they feel confident in themselves to go out and achieve, regardless of their postcode or which field they choose to enter. It is these innovative ideas from the Scottish Conservatives that will help regrow our economy as we emerge from this pandemic, and I look forward to supporting the bills that my party will bring forward, which shows that we have Scotland's interests at heart. To conclude, Presiding Officer, for Scotland to recover fully, we need a government which is 100% focused on rebuilding Scotland. Our country is still deeply divided from past referendums, and we must use this time to pull our country back together. I therefore call on the SNP to put Scotland's recovery first, to rebuild our country, which is free of the constitutional arguments which has divided our country for far too long.
Thank you. Thank you. I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Michael Mara. This is Ms Thompson's first speech in this chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome you to your place. It's a great honour to be called to speak in this debate as the new member for Falkirk East, and I'd like to put on record my grateful thanks to everyone who's helped me get to this point, and in particular, my constituents. The previous distinguished member, Angus MacDonald, was noted for his hard work, complete commitment to the people of Falkirk East, and his drive to bring new ideas and innovation to the fore. In that respect, his qualities are perhaps a metaphor for the qualities we need to shape post-pandemic Scotland. Reflecting for a moment on history, in the aftermath of World War II, no country sought to return to the past. A new international order had to be built. Many nations sought to reprioritise their domestic agendas and fundamentally change the face of their societies. Empires broke up, and many countries entered the world stage as independent states. We face a different context, but the response must be no less ambitious and no less audacious. That is why I applaud the first 100 days plan from our Scottish Government, but note, it's only the start of our ambitions. I particularly welcome the support for business and the economy. My friend Professor David Simpson has recently spoken about the need to move beyond talking about economic growth or green growth to one of economic development, a sentiment with which I agree. It allows us to capture within economic strategy our commitment to well-being, and I welcome the recent report by the Social Justice and Fairness Commission. In my opinion, a key feature of economic development for Scotland must include becoming the most talent-friendly country in the world. We must become much more entrepreneurial in outlook and in practice, and we must encourage the type of entrepreneurial activity that supports our climate change and environmental ambitions. Women must be at the heart of this. But there's also a qualitative richness to our society that is part of our ambitions. I have a long-standing interest in music and was heartened by the ideas for it in our manifesto. Music not only enriches our lives, but develops cognitive capacity in children. The arts also contribute a great deal in terms of GVA that can often be overlooked. And let's face it, music brings us joy. Whether in music or in manufacturing, financial services or tourism, people and skills are at the heart of everything. That's why I welcome the ambition to put skills centre stage, particularly for young people as we move out of the pandemic. But we can go further. It's time we move beyond ideas of skill competence and embrace the pursuit of excellence. It's time we stop limiting our ambitions by comparing ourselves mainly with the rest of the UK. We should be in the forefront of international benchmarking. We should be fully engaging with international movements such as World Skills, just as we want to retain the full benefits of international programmes such as Erasmus. In addition to our domestic ambitions, we need to think about how Scotland is positioned and seen far beyond our borders. I've been involved in researching Scotland's business diaspora, communicating with over 1,000 business leaders in 74 countries. A key positive feature of Scotland the brand includes having a reputation for fair dealing, for being trustworthy, and a strong ethical business environment. These positive qualities need not only to be safeguarded but developed. They need our focus more than ever, given the trashing of values by the Tories in Westminster. Dependence on Westminster is a dead weight holding back our ambitions in Scotland, and we must be up to the challenge of standing by the rights of the people of Scotland to safeguard our own future. The most successful countries in the world are countries of similar size to Scotland, whether we measure this in terms of economic development, being the least corrupt countries, or having the happiest citizens. Unlike Scotland, they are independent. This is therefore no time to limit our ambitions. I cannot and will not accept a paucity of ambition for Scotland. It's time we too joined the international community of independent nations, and I'm looking forward to putting my heft behind doing everything I can for Scotland and my constituents in Falkirk East. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Michael Mara to be followed by Colette Stevenson. This is Michael Mara's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a singular honour to give my first speech in our Parliament as a representative for the North East of Scotland and to do so in the first debate of this session. I thank all of my colleagues for your welcome and support, and particularly Labour members for their acceptance of what some are calling the Mara downgrade. I'd like to extend my thanks for the welcome afforded to all new members by parliamentary staff in what remain very challenging times for them and their families. Most of all, I'd like to thank the people of the North East for affording me the opportunity to serve. That is, of course, all we ask. So each new session of Parliament is a new stage on a journey begun long ago and which has no end. And that is to invite perspective of our small efforts set in our long history and the greater hope of our future. History will record a pandemic of a scale unseen in a century that has profoundly changed our way of life and the global ramifications of which we can only guess at so far. The immediate consequence of this, of course, is, as of this morning, 10,114 loved souls lost to families across the breadth of our land. And our response must rapidly be to evolve the speed of the rollout of the vaccine to ensure as few further lives as possible are lost. But across Scotland, our lockdown has created an unemployment crisis, particularly for the young, an education crisis, which we're only beginning to grasp, and a health crisis in what remains one of the sickest countries in Europe. Childcare, transport, retail, international travel. This level of simultaneous disruption is truly unprecedented. And recovery will demand the fullest efforts of the entire nation. Lockdowns have worked, but are of course a product of failure. We did not act quickly enough. Our public health system was weakened by years of cuts. We failed to contact trace. We did not shut the airports. And what followed were necessary acts of communal restraint until our scientists could bail out our governments. That we were unprepared is unquestionable, but our unforgivable vulnerability was neglect, decline and division. We came into this crisis far weaker, more vulnerable than one of the richest countries on earth should have been. As inequality has grown, our social fabric has weakened. We can now see this anew, not just as a moral affront, but a practical impediment to our shared lives. Respiratory disease, obesity, unsafe workplaces without trade unions, poor housing, services less accessible to ethnic minorities. Grotesque and growing health inequality, proven by stagnant life expectancy and the gap between the richest and the poorest growing ever greater. One quarter of our children, and each day more and more, living in grinding poverty. Our most impoverished communities, like parts of my city of Dundee, are beset by the worst drugs crisis in the world. That's an extraordinary national shame. And let us not doubt that if this was any middle-class epidemic, we would have locked down, legislated, incurred unlimited debt, educated widely and reformed indiscriminately. The great inconvenience of these dead Scots is that their passing cannot be, by any conscious examination of the facts, be blamed on the demon other. Drug laws are the same across this United Kingdom, yet drug deaths in Scotland are four times that of England. These Scots died because they were poor and they were believed somehow to be worth less. Well, they were my schoolmates. I stood with them on the terracing. Each of them were sons, daughters, parents and friends. This is inequality, not how it starts, but certainly how it ends. And no real recovery is possible unless we address the broader inequalities. We must find the ways and the will to deal with these things together. During the election campaign, the First Minister said, tellingly, I believe, that in the end, politics is about picking sides. That's not how I see politics. I believe, in all honesty, that we do have common cause. Politics can be about building movements, starting and winning debates, creating common purpose in a workplace, in a street, in a town, in a city, in a country, and around the world. That is the ethos that we need in our recovery. Taking every road to what divides us rather than what we have in common is an easy route, but it will lead ultimately and inevitably to despair. This is a time, globally, when fame and often power is forged in division, in loud words rather than considered action. And I would counsel caution on one issue locally in recent days. Ministers have spoken of anti-Catholic hatred. Strong words, but for 200 years we have listened to the same old songs in Scotland. Ministers have now decided it is time, in their words, to call it out. But the Catholic community in Scotland has organised. We won hard-earned protections, we integrated and we survived. We have our voice and we know how to use it. And I have to say there is deep unease at this old siege becoming a new front in what we are invited to call the culture wars. And I am sure that is not the intent, but there are real risks in how we portray and we deal with these issues as they are rightly pursued. Instead, let us look to dialogue, to education, to justice and to peace. In all of this, we can be sure that a politics that elevates sentiment over action will be the end of progress. So in this moment of pandemic crisis, there is a rightful expectation that we do act deliberately, with consideration, but with principled intent to make better Scotland's ills.
It does fall to us to bind the nation's wounds, to care for those who shall have borne the battle. We must, as we shape our recovery, work together for a future built from the first principles of social justice.
Thank you, Mr. Marra. Before I call the final speaker in the open debate, can I just remind members who have been participating in the debate they do need to be in the chamber for closing speeches. And with that, I call our final speaker in the open debate, Colette Stevenson, and members will wish to be aware that this is Ms. Stevenson's first speech in this chamber. Ms. Stevenson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I welcome you to your new role. Congratulations. Firstly, I would like to thank the people of East Kilbride. It is an honour to be standing here representing my hometown in our National Parliament. Secondly, I want to add that being a fourth-generation daughter from the original village of East Kilbride, this is indeed a special privilege. I want to pay tribute to my predecessor, Linda Fabiani, who served East Kilbride so well for so many years. Linda has been a friend and a mentor to me and has left a fantastic legacy which I intend to build on. East Kilbride has faced a few challenges in recent years and COVID has added to this. I want to reflect briefly on some of the community spirit that has helped East Kilbride to get through the pandemic. Community organisations managed to respond quickly to the crisis. The town has had food banks for several years, including the East Kilbride Churches and Loaves and Fishes, and they had to ramp up their work, supported by local residents donating more than usual. Share Alike were able to deliver food packages to people across the town, as did Older and Active in East Kilbride. Alongside a much-valued prescription delivery service, ensuring elderly and shielding residents could still get access to medication. The Council's community engagement team have also been working hard to support these organisations. Staff at Hare Myers Hospital have gone above and beyond in caring for people and ensuring the hospital has remained available for a range of treatments, whether COVID-related or not. We have also seen that the Alistair McCoy's complex turned into a super vaccination centre. I want to thank everyone involved for helping to deliver thousands of vaccine doses in a very efficient manner. I look forward to working with the NHS Lanarkshire and the staff at Hare Myers and in GP practices and health centres as we now, hopefully, forge ahead with our NHS recovery. Our teachers at the four secondary schools and many primary schools in the town have continued to deliver for our children and young people, aided by many support staff, including cleaners, whose roles have become even more essential. Like all retail areas, East Kilbride's town centre has had challenges, particularly with large retailers like M&S and Debenhams having to shut up shop. As a shopping centre rather than a high street, there are additional barriers. In the early days of lockdown, most shops had to remain closed even when the high streets had reopened. The Scottish Government's COVID-related grant schemes have offered a lifeline for many businesses, and the extension of rates relief for another year will, I am sure, safeguard many jobs and livelihoods. With continued easing of restrictions and the further rollout of the vaccination programme, I hope footfall will increase and the town's businesses will be able to succeed again. Over the five-year course of this Parliament, we have so many challenges to face up to, but we also have many opportunities. East Kilbride needs more social housing. Our young people deserve the right to employment or training, and our public services and staff need the tools to recover properly. The SNP's government's plans will tackle these challenges, and with the full power of independence, I know we will do so much more. As well as a manifesto full to the brim with policy ideas, I know the Scottish Government has been working hard to implement our 100-day plan. The commitment outlined there will provide great foundations for going forward. And it's great to see Kate Forbes with an expanded portfolio covering finance and economy. And I know she will continue to deliver for people right across the country. I welcome Tom Arthur's appointment, and I look forward to hearing more about the government's plans on community wealth building. The Scottish Government has an excellent record on fair employment practices. I hope we can encourage more businesses to become living wage employers, offer more apprenticeships, and implement other fair work principles. Our recovery must and will be multifaceted, focusing on health, society, the economy, and the environment. One great achievement of the SNP since entering government in 2007 has been the decision to invest in infrastructure, building new schools, new hospitals, better transport links brings obvious benefits and importantly creates jobs. For example, our manifesto commitment to build 100,000 more affordable homes in the next decade will support 14,000 jobs per year. The Transport Secretary will be pleased, or perhaps not, to hear that I plan to be as vocal as my predecessor on the matter of East Kilbride railway line. By drilling and electrifying the line, I hope the railway will better serve the needs of the people of East Kilbride. And more people will consider using the train as a green alternative to driving. The government's intention to bring ScotRail into public ownership will provide additional benefits for passengers. Over the next 5 years, I want to work at a local and national level to get East Kilbride back on track and to make it a more vibrant town going forward. For me, that includes engaging with small and medium-sized businesses, in particular to see how we can start to use more local businesses and build our community wealth. We need a recovery that works for everyone, and we have an opportunity to reimagine the kind of society we need and want. I commend the Scottish Government's work on this so far, and I look forward to hearing more in the debate scheduled over the next couple of weeks. Presiding Officer, I'm honoured to be here serving the people of East Kilbride, and I look forward to championing the town. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ms Stevenson. We now move to closing speeches, and can I call Mark Ruskell to close on behalf of the Green Party. Mr Ruskell.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I welcome you to your role? Can I also welcome the two Cabinet Secretaries to their roles as well? I believe that you'll bring a breadth of experience cross-portfolio to your new roles and help to lead us through this recovery from COVID. One of the things which the Deputy First Minister mentioned in his opening comments was the need for innovation and the need for collaboration in this chamber. And I've been actually quite heartened by what I've heard this afternoon in this debate across all parties, that we have considerable strengths across this chamber and we're going to be able to rise to that challenge. And I particularly welcome the contributions from new members. I'm not going to be able to mention everybody here, but what I took out of all the speeches this afternoon is that there's an incredible level of lived experience, there's a connection to communities, and there's a diversity here as well. And I'd particularly like to emphasise the contribution made by Mr Gulhani, Mr Mara as well, and Gillian Mackay too. And I think all of us reflected on Pam Duncan Glancy's first speech in this Parliament as well. Those words, as long as I'm here, you are not alone, those will ring out from this chamber this afternoon and be heard across Scotland, so congratulations. And we've got diversity here. We've got diversity, also political thought. And I absolutely welcome Maggie Chapman's challenge, actually, to every single member in this Parliament to design an economy as if people mattered. We need to take on the big issues here. We need to think about restructuring our economy. We've got lots of lessons to learn, and I think that's why an independent public inquiry called for by Alex Cole-Hamilton and many other members is absolutely pressing. And I think the most obvious lesson that all governments around these islands and in Europe have to learn is that we didn't treat this virus as a SARS virus. We treated it as a flu virus. And as a result, major mistakes were made. Now, the previous COVID committee in the last parliament took evidence on this. And Professor Woolhouse from the University of Edinburgh said, and I quote, "We did our homework, but when we were given the exam, it was the wrong test." Governments simply got it wrong. They planned for a flu virus. It was something far more serious than that. And when we also took evidence from New Zealand, from Professor Baker, who led New Zealand's response to the virus, they admitted that they got it wrong early on as well. They were caught on the hop. They didn't have adequate planning, but they were prepared to learn. They learned very quickly from the experience in China. They learned very quickly from the evidence that came out of the Taiwanese plan to tackle the virus back in 2003. And what they did is they put their flu plan effectively in reverse. They threw everything at COVID in the beginning, instead of what we did, which was to gradually increase the response as the virus worsened. So we have got serious lessons to learn here. And I think back to, you know, March last year, when unfortunately our chief medical officer at the time was on the TV advising people that it was perfectly safe to go to Six Nations matches. And I think we need a long, hard look at our preparedness for dealing with pandemics in the months to come. But we must become more prepared for the future. You know, we finally got that testing capacity. The Greens made that case early on that we needed to ramp it up. That will be critical now in dealing with the later stages of this pandemic and preparing for the future. And we need to ensure there's proper support for people to do the right thing and self-isolate as well. You know, no one should have had to choose between going to work to earn a wage and self-isolating. But although the self-isolation grants, the criteria for those grants were widened twice as a result of Green pressure in the last session, we're still seeing high levels of people being rejected from receiving those grants, still having to make that choice between going to work and doing the right thing. And, you know, the BBC had figures last night on the TV. 45% of people were rejected in recent months from those grants. So, you know, it shouldn't be a question of entitlement to benefits. These grants should be available instantly at a decent level, and they should be universal as well, alongside a package of wider support to help people to do the right thing whenever there's a pandemic. We've had a wide-ranging debate this afternoon. In the remaining time that I've got, I just want to point on education. I mean, I think Murdo Fraser raised an important point around the challenges that young people have around exam-style assessments. But I would say, look, let's go further than that. Let's question why we have exams full stop. Why can we not have continuous assessment? We need to think big in terms of education and closing the attainment gap. Members have also talked about the huge toll on business that we've seen. I think we've all seen that. I've seen it in my high street in Stirling as well, shops closing down. But, you know, the way to avoid that cycle of lockdowns would have been to have taken the bold move early on to actually have a full lockdown to get the virus under control. And I think, you know, the point made by Anas Sarwar as well is that, yes, business needs that certainty going forward. We need to get back into a regular cycle of announcements from the Scottish Government and parliamentary scrutiny. So it's important that the machinery of this Parliament gets up and running again, that we have a COVID committee that can go through the data, can take expert evidence and assess the restrictions on a week-to-week basis. That's something that we have to do as a cross-party basis, and we will do that. In terms of the health service, I think Gillian Mackay absolutely nailed it. It's about fair pay, but it's also about the working conditions, and it's about moving away from the crisis management that we've seen with mental health and the drugs crisis, which Michael Marra so eloquently spoke about as well. And that defining mission that Gillian Mackay spoke about, the National Care Service, has to be at the heart of this Parliament's work. So thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to finish Paul McLennan's John Muir quote, "The power of imagination makes us infinite." Thanks for reminding us about that. Absolutely, that's what we should be aiming for the stars.
Thank you, Mr. Ruskell. Can I now call on Jackie Bailey to close for the Labour Party? Ms. Bailey, thank you.
Thank you very much, and can I welcome you, Deputy Presiding Officer, to your new role. Can I also congratulate all those who have made their maiden speeches today, All of them were fantastic, but let me pick out three in particular, from Pam Duncan-Glancy, from Sandesh Gulhaney, and from Michael Mara, and say to my colleagues that this has raised the bar for all of us. And I very much look forward to working with Gillian Mackay in the health portfolio. Now, as many have said, the last 15 months have been some of the most challenging that many of us have ever experienced. And I want to begin by sending my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one through COVID and to thank NHS, social care and council staff who have worked so hard to keep us safe. Over 10,000 people in Scotland have now died of COVID-19, well over a third of which were care home residents. Each loss is devastating, and many people with no underlying health conditions ended up on life support machines, showing just how seriously each and every one of us must continue to take this. And what is particularly hard to come to terms with is the scale of death within our care homes, the way that our older people and care home staff were treated, who worked round the clock caring for us, is nothing short of a national scandal. Figures are still emerging, which show the true extent of the impact of COVID in our care homes. The families of those who died, as well as the staff, deserve answers, and that's why a public inquiry is essential. I don't think we can wait for a Four Nations inquiry. Many of these decisions were taken exclusively in Scotland. We need an inquiry in Scotland. Now, I think we all watched in a degree of shock yesterday as Dominic Cummings outlined the chaos at the heart of the UK government. And what is true is that the approach taken by the UK government was mirrored in the early stages of the pandemic by the Scottish government. And let me illustrate this with a Channel 4 interview about herd immunity. Scotland's National Clinical Director, Jason Leach, was asked, "Do you agree with Sir Patrick Vallance, the Chief Scientific Advisor, that one of the aims of the UK government is for people to develop some immunity to this disease?" Jason Leach's response, "I do. I absolutely agree with him because we have no choice." So the SNP went along with some of the decisions of the UK government exposed yesterday by Mr Cummings. And as Michael Mara rightly said, the government failed to deal with the pandemic quickly enough. This cannot be allowed to happen ever again. But, presiding officer, what started out as a health crisis very quickly became a crisis affecting every part of our society. Our economy, our education system, and normal everyday life. Businesses have gone to the wall. Many are still struggling to survive. Thousands of workers lost their jobs immediately, and hundreds of thousands were put on furlough. GDP has fallen by a staggering 8.4%. Unemployment has risen to 123,000. And for some of the 300,000 people on furlough, there is a potential for more job losses as this unwinds. The scale of the challenge is huge. It is more significant than the banking crisis, which took 10 years for the country to recover from. And unfortunately, the challenge we face is not yet matched by the scale of the ambition required from government. Let me illustrate this by talking about Fair Start Scotland. Just 14% of those enrolled in the first 3 years of Fair Start managed to sustain employment for more than 12 months. What is even worse is that over 13,000 people had left the scheme early, almost 3,000 more people than the number of participants who actually started a job. There is no point in introducing a job scheme if the majority of people do not end up in sustained employment. We are facing a very real impending jobs crisis, and the SNP's existing programmes lack ambition and will not deliver for the scale of the challenge required. Scottish Labour set out plans to guarantee every young person and the long-term unemployed and those with a disability a job in the public sector for 6 months in a comprehensive programme to tackle the jobs crisis. But we also need action to help businesses to remobilise, action to stimulate growth, action to reinvigorate our tourism and hospitality sector, so vital to jobs and the economy. Scottish Labour suggested a £75 debit card to spend on our struggling high streets. We also had exciting proposals for a great Scottish staycation, both of which I would commend to ministers. But turning to education, our young people have had a really tough time. They've been out of school for the best part of the year, isolated from their friends, missing out on education and opportunities. Our young people cannot be made to suffer any longer. Yet they face a second year of chaos with their school qualifications, which is causing anxiety and misery to thousands of families across Scotland. Now, I know the Cabinet Secretary has left the education portfolio, but I hope he would agree it is essential that his replacement publishes the appeals process next week. We must have a reset guarantee for all affected pupils, and the Scottish Government must work with colleagues in colleges and universities to ensure that no young person misses out as a result of the pandemic. Turning to the NHS and social care, there is no doubt that the work done by staff at the front line of the pandemic was truly heroic. Many of them went to work without adequate PPE. They put themselves and their families in danger whilst doing their very best to care for us. Many of them are now considering early retirement because they feel burnt out. That will have a huge impact on remobilisation plans. But workforce capacity is not a new problem. The Scottish Government has been told about workforce capacity many, many times over successive years. But the problem is not yet fixed. Nicola Sturgeon, when she was Health Secretary, was warned by the RCN and the BMA that cuts to the number of nurses and doctors would have severe consequences. But she didn't listen, and now the NHS suffers as a result. Pam Duncan-Glancy rightly made the point that many problems existed before the pandemic, but COVID made it worse. It has served to heighten inequalities. Nowhere is that more obvious than in access to mental health services. We need an urgent increase in inpatient, outpatient and crisis mental health services, and we need it because we face an impending crisis. Waiting times were also bad before the pandemic. They are even worse now. 62 patients were waiting for treatment in 2012 when the treatment time guarantee of 12 weeks was introduced. 62,000 are waiting now. We also know that at least 7,000 people have cancer but have not been diagnosed and they've not been treated. A catch-up programme is urgent or people could lose their lives. We've made a number of suggestions that I will talk about when we debate the recovery of the NHS next week. But let me conclude by talking about the government's cross-party COVID recovery group. We need to look at recovery in the short and the long term, and we need to recognise that COVID will still be with us, and I look forward to making a contribution to that group. But we need to plan for the continued suppression of the virus. That means targeted business support. That means robust testing and tracing that responds rapidly to outbreaks. That means improvement to the self-isolation grant, and that means ramping up vaccinations. There are 980,000 doses of vaccine allocated to Scotland that remain unused. We are behind Wales. We're behind England in the vaccination programme. There's no doubt that while Scotland and the UK stockpiled vaccines, in Wales they got the vaccine into people's arms. So I welcome the Health Secretary's promise to speed things up, and I would recommend mass testing and mass vaccinations, especially in areas like Glasgow. Finally, Presiding Officer, let me say that we on these benches will work with the government, the business community, our colleagues in local government, the voluntary sector, and those in the health and social care sector to build a recovery, to build that fairer Scotland. But we will be critical of the government if they fail to heed the lessons that they need to learn about our recovery.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. And I now call on Annie Wells to close for the Conservatives. You have around 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I too would like to welcome you to your new role. Today's maiden speeches were fantastic maiden speeches. There's a couple of ones that, again, I would like to just sort of pull out of there. I thought Pam Duncan-Clancy's speech was phenomenal. It was passionate. It was powerful, as was Dr. Sandesh Gulhani. But everyone's speeches right across the chamber has showed what a breadth of talent that this Parliament has and has gained more of. So I would just like to start with that. And I would also like to congratulate John Swinney on his new role, and congratulate my fellow Glasgow MSP, Humza Yousaf, in his appointment as Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. To oversee this vital portfolio is a huge responsibility in normal circumstances, but to do so as Scotland remains amidst a global pandemic is truly a significant challenge, and I do wish you well on that. And I would also like to stress that my appointment as Shadow Cabinet Secretary for the Conservative Party, alongside my brilliant team, Sandesh Gulhani, who gave, again, a very powerful maiden speech, Sue Webber and Craig Hoy, I am open to having constructive relationships with the government where possible. But the Cabinet Secretary will also be aware that my Scottish Conservative colleagues and I will not hesitate to hold the government accountable when there have been clear shortcomings. Presiding Officer, assessing where we currently are as a country in our battle against COVID, the light at the end of the tunnel is certainly getting that bit brighter. Thanks to the sheer brilliance of the scientific community, both at home and internationally, each dose of the vaccine is steadily guiding us towards freedom, which I am certain we will never take for granted again. The vaccination rollout has been a success story in Scotland and the United Kingdom as a whole, demonstrating the overwhelming benefits of working together to emerge from this pandemic. However, as my colleague Murdo Fraser highlighted, there remain significant and difficult questions to answer, particularly maximising uptake as we proceed down the younger age groups. There is no question that vaccines are our best route to reducing restrictions, which continue to have a huge impact on Scotland's economy, especially in Glasgow, where many businesses have been, quite frankly, struggling to survive. Therefore, to echo what has already been said loudly and clearly by the Scottish and UK governments, when you get the call, go and get the jag. Presiding Officer, as we all know, the NHS has been placed under immense strain, and yet even before the pandemic began, there were serious concerns over the NHS backlog. Now, as we look to emerge from the immediate threat of the pandemic, the NHS backlog is at great risk of spiralling out of control. While there is rightly been a focus within our NHS on tackling COVID, it is also true that thousands of non-COVID-related appointments, treatments and operations have been postponed due to the pandemic. It was revealed only this week, as shown by the latest Public Health Scotland statistics, that around 28,000 patients have spent 52 weeks or more on NHS lists awaiting planned hospital treatment. And meanwhile, as of March 2021, around 100,000 Scots are still waiting on key diagnostic tests. Leading charities such as Cancer Research UK have already expressed deep concern over the ongoing backlog of individuals waiting to receive critical tests and receive a diagnosis. To confront this challenge head-on, the Scottish Conservatives called for an additional £600 million to tackle the NHS treatment backlog in 2021-22. Suffice to say, the NHS continues to face one of the most challenging periods in its history. The substantial impact of failing to tackle the backlog will be felt by tens of thousands of people across the country, and it must be a top priority for the Cabinet Secretary if we are to avert a full-blown healthcare crisis. Presiding Officer, the impact of COVID-19 on our social care system has also been felt by thousands across Scotland. For too long, this cruel virus has meant families of care home residents had been separated from loved ones, unable to give them support, even so much as a hug. Since the beginning of the pandemic, the Scottish Conservatives have consistently pressed for a judge-led public inquiry over the 3,000 deaths from coronavirus in Scotland's care homes. This Parliament voted for this twice. The last Parliament voted for this twice, but it was ignored. This has been an unprecedented pandemic, so of course mistakes have been made. However, the actions taken by ministers at that time must be properly scrutinised. The reasoning behind these crucial mistakes must be established, particularly in regard to moving elderly patients from hospitals into care homes. The government has a responsibility to give those families who've lost loved ones, tragically passed away from COVID, in care home settings. They deserve the closure, not only that they need, but they do frankly deserve it. Looking ahead to the future of social care reform in Scotland, The Scottish Conservatives support many of the recommendations put forward in the failure review, including viewing social care as an equal partner to the NHS. And I will look forward to engaging in further discussion with the Cabinet Secretary, councils, families and providers on this matter in the coming weeks. An issue that remains very close to my heart and one that has been exacerbated by the pandemic is the drug death crisis in Scotland. And it is time we took meaningful steps towards ending this. In my own area of Springburn, I've saw firsthand the impact drugs has on victims themselves, their families and the wider community. Although the government finally admitted more could have been done to prevent people losing their lives to drugs, we need divisive action now. In this light, and as Douglas Ross said yesterday, the Scottish Conservatives have appealed for cross-party support to tackle drug deaths by opening up access to treatment and rehab programmes. Stemming from my Right to Recovery motion, we will be reaching out across parties in the Chamber, and I am determined to help build a consensus around new legislation that ensures no one is denied the rehab support they need. As has been mentioned before, the success of the vaccine rollout means that we are more confident than ever that we can soon put this pandemic behind us. However, we must acknowledge that the peak of the mental health impact of this pandemic is still ahead of us. And so mental health support and treatment must be another top priority for this government over this parliament. The Centre for Mental Health have recently estimated that across the UK, a staggering 10 million people may need mental health support. Here in Scotland, the latest statistics suggest that up to a fifth of people in Scotland are waiting too long for mental health treatment. And that picture is even more concerning for young people, as over 1,000 children and young people have waited over a year to begin vital treatment. The Scottish Conservatives had called for the share of the health funding spent on mental health to be increased to 10% by the end of this parliament. But as much as more funding will help, we also need practical steps to improve services and ultimately get better treatment for those who need support. To that end, we also suggested there should be a permanent shift towards community mental health services by expanding programmes such as cognitive behavioural therapy, social prescribing and exercise referral schemes, and also peer support. Presiding officer, in summing up, as a nation, we have a significant challenge ahead of us, and it's time, and time is quickly running out to act. From the NHS backlog to the mental health crisis, this Parliament must be 100% focused on rebuilding Scotland. The differences in political opinion in this chamber are stark, and we all know that. However, with the immense gravity of some of the challenges ahead, I believe the best interests of the Scottish people will be served if we can cooperate in many of the areas that I have outlined this afternoon, and the Scottish Conservatives are ready to put recovery first. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wells. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary for Health to wind up today's debate. I'd be very grateful, Mr Yousaf, if you could take us up to around 10 to 5.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I welcome you to your role as well? Can I start off, Presiding Officer, by saying how very grateful I am for the opportunity to close today's debate as the new Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care and to listen to some phenomenal speeches, extraordinarily powerful speeches, and very, very passionate speeches from new members in particular, and the old-timers weren't too bad either. Let me say a word or two, because others have talked about their predecessors. Let me also pay tribute to the former Cabinet Secretary for Health, Jean Freeman. Many members have come up to me to say you've got very big shoes to fill. I'm not convinced I'll be able to fill those shoes quite as Jean Freeman did, but I will do my best to do as well as she did. And history will judge her, I think, very kindly, as somebody who took the toughest of decisions in the toughest of times. Many people have said to me also from across the chamber, I don't envy you with the job you have. That is true, but it also, as Annie Wells rightly reflected, is a huge honour to be the Health Secretary or Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care at any time, let alone being entrusted with that responsibility during, again, these most challenging of times. And I will do my best, and I promise you to try this, and at times I'm sure I will falter, but I will do my best to work cross-party for the national interest, which we are all focused on, and of course is the focus of this very, very debate. Let me also start by doing as the Deputy First Minister did, and passing on my deepest condolences to all of those who have lost loved ones during this pandemic. This virus has touched every family, it's touched every community in Scotland. And when we say that about passing on our condolences, it's because we should remind ourselves in the heat of debate, and there will be plenty of very challenging debate around this very issue of COVID recovery, that ultimately what we are doing is trying to pay the ultimate respect to those who have passed on, and that is to learn the lessons, to make sure we can do everything we can to recover. Let me start also by referencing again those phenomenal first speeches by a number of members right across the chamber. I'm going to try to speak to as many of them as possible, but particularly those who asked questions of me in summing up. So let me welcome Gillian Mackay to the health portfolio. I look forward to working constructively with her. I thought she made an excellent speech with a number of very good points, but she touched particularly on mental health support for NHS staff. I thought it was a really, really important point for us to raise. And I was at Monklands Hospital yesterday, my first official visit. I was delighted to meet the staff there. Staff there was in very good hands of senior nurse Karen Gowdy and many others at Monklands Hospital. I want to thank them for the care and attention that they gave me during my visit. But every single person I spoke to, the nurses, the doctors, the consultant, the porter, the cleaning staff, every single one of them told me it has been the most challenging, the most difficult 14 months of their lives. But they also all said to me that they were indebted to, as they described it, the NHS family, that they'd all pulled together. But it is my responsibility and our collective responsibility to ensure that we do everything we can to support their mental health. And we are doing that with the Mental Wellbeing Hub, but there is more we can do, and I accept Gillian Mackay's challenge in that regard. She spoke also very well, and Mark Ruskell mentioned this in his summing up, and a number of other members talked about the importance of the social care sector. And again, if any of us were ever in doubt of that importance, and none of us should ever be so, then of course the last 14 months have challenged us all in that regard. And therefore, I'm delighted to be working closely with Kevin Stewart, who will be the minister who will take forward, to help take forward our national care service, and already done a lot of work in the first week in the role in that regard. And of course, in our first 100 days, we will launch a consultation in relation to that national care service so we can improve those terms and conditions. She also mentioned, Gillian Mackay, in her remarks about looking above and beyond CBT. She mentioned that CBT was very important. I can assure her that my wife, who is a counsellor who deals with pluralism, also tells me that they have to look above and beyond CBT too. So as much as I get pressure in the chamber, I also get it at home too. Can I speak to a number of other members? Neil Gray spoke again extraordinarily well. He is a seasoned politician, but his first contribution in this chamber. He asked me about close contact services and when the guidance would be updated. It got updated yesterday, and I've sent him on the link while we were in the chamber. He is a good friend of mine. He is going to make an extraordinary contribution to this chamber, I have no doubt. Stephen Kerr, I thought, also spoke powerfully, asking me a number of questions. I was really interested to hear about his background. I wasn't in the Parliament when he made that contribution from on behalf of his church. I didn't know he was from a preacher to a politician. Some might suggest he's gone from a saint to a sinner. I wouldn't do such a thing. But the serious points, of course, he raises, and he questioned me. And again, I welcome that challenge. It was around vaccine rollout, and a number of other members did as well. The reason why I'm pushing as hard as possible to go as fast as possible is because JCVI guidance has changed from the second dose being administered from 12 weeks can now be administered from 8 weeks. We're pushing our health boards to go faster to schedule those appointments earlier on, but also because we have a good supply of AstraZeneca, which has not always been the case, because as members will know, AstraZeneca, the guidance is not to use that for under 40s where possible, and therefore we have that supply available to hopefully increase the second doses to that cohort that is over the age of 40. In terms of the performance in relation to the NHS and its recovery, a number of members raised that and have referenced the fact that I have said that it will take longer than weeks and months. And I have to be honest about that. As Health Secretary, I could sit here and pretend to give a figure that I could pluck out of the air when I could tell you when we will have NHS performance, not just at pre-COVID levels, but I want us to go even better than pre-COVID levels, as a number of members have challenged me. But I can't pluck that figure out of thin air. That's why the NHS recovery plan, which I hope will be a cross-party effort and can get cross-party endorsement, is important to publish in the first 100 days. It doesn't mean in the first 100 days we're going to get that NHS recovery. I will do my best to push things as far and as hard as I possibly can. But I have already written to each of the health spokespeople, emailed them to ask them to come meet with me. I'm sure we'll meet very, very soon. And part of that conversation will be around the NHS. A substantial part of that conversation will be about the remobilisation of the NHS. Turning to Pam Duncan-Glancy, you are rightly getting plaudits from across the chamber because it was one of the, if not the best opening speech or first speech I've ever heard from a member. You quoted John Smith extraordinarily well in terms of the opportunity to serve, as I think did Michael Mara too. And I cannot speak for him, but I know his family well, as I suspect you do, and I'm sure he would be very, very proud to see you and his family very proud to see you in this chamber. You are not just excellent in your own right, very clearly, but there will be many, many, many people who will look up to you as a role model. And I was not the only one, I suspect, who had a lump in their throat and was about to shed a tear watching your interview at the Emirates when you were first introduced as Pam Duncan-Glancy, MSP. So you will be a fighter, and I look forward to working with you. Maggie Chapman challenged all of us in relation to the economy and challenged us in relation to an economy that focuses on well-being, that focuses on human beings as person-centres and people-centres. I know Ben McPherson and his role and a number of others will be looking forward to working closely with you, as will I. Can I turn to Dr. Sandesh Gohani, who I've been impressed with right throughout. He and I were political opponents in Glasgow Pollock. I was impressed with him then, and I'm even more impressed with him now. I thought he spoke very emotively, very emotionally, very powerfully about his own role in the NHS, for which I thank him throughout the pandemic, but also extremely emotively about the challenges he faces as a father in the NHS. And that really struck a chord with me. I'm a new father, 2 years old, but it seems like she was just born a moment ago. And I cannot imagine not hugging my newborn daughter for 8 weeks. So I really do commend you for the sacrifices that you've made, but also for the fact that in your opening speech, you have said that you will be a champion for the NHS, and I look forward to working cross-party with Dr. Gohani. Megan Gallagher spoke very well on a number of issues, but particularly about education. I look forward to speaking, having many discussions with you about health, but I'm sure my colleague Charlie Ann Somerville will look forward to speaking with you around education. You asked about our education recovery plan. Again, my colleague Ms. Somerville will, of course, give more detail of that in the debate next week, but it has already been said, of course, we are putting a significant amount of money into education recovery, not just funding councils to increase teacher numbers by 1,000 and classroom assistance by 500. That's part of our commitment to 3,500 additional teachers. But that summer programme, which so many people, again, have rightly asked questions about, hugely, hugely important too. I am the stepfather, stepdaughter, who is 12. She's in that transition between primary school and she'll be going into high school. It's been really tough, because that is the year you probably enjoy the most as a child of that age. And she may lose some of her friends as different friends go to different high schools. And she has really felt it. So we can promise you that, of course, our focus will be on their educational attainment, of course, but also the other important aspects of life that our young people have missed out on, play, on socialising, and so on and so forth. But again, my colleague, Shirley Ann, will give more details to that. Can I also commend Michelle Thompson, Michael Mara, Paul McLennan, and Colette Stevenson, forgive me, for all of their first speeches as well. In the remainder of the time I have, I will try to address a couple of other issues that were raised, if I may. A number of people have rightly asked me about Glasgow, and can I say to Anna Sawar, who has spoken well this week about the challenges facing Glasgow, both he and I represent that city and represent the South Side. Both our father's businesses have been in the South Side. My father's business is still in the South Side and has been there for 40 years. We both went to the same school in Glasgow South Side too. So we have a love and a desire to see that part of the city do well, but also the city as a whole come out of the current challenge it is in. I can give them an absolute guarantee that where there are those clusters in the south side of Glasgow in particular, they are getting our urgent and immediate focus. So vaccination in those hotspots have been prioritised for 18 to 29-year-olds. He asked about walk-ins for 18 to 29-year-olds. That is a very fair question and a very fair challenge. It's something, again, that is urgently being explored. But we do have to be careful, because where our priority will often be on the second doses, because that gives you, for the current variant that we're dealing with, 88% effectiveness. For one dose, you only get 33% effectiveness. So for an older cohort that we know are more vulnerable and susceptible to severe illness, possibly to death, there is a priority for that older cohort to get the second dosage for maximum protection. But can we do both? Can we maximise the second dosage as well as having walk-ins for 18 to 29-year-olds and the other cohorts below 40? I think that's a fair challenge. I can promise him something I'm looking at. In terms of the do not attends, which a number of members have mentioned across the chamber, I've made it very clear to health boards right across Scotland that when they get towards the end of the day, if they have any leftover vaccine, then my expectation is that they put immediate calls out, as the Hydro did a couple of weeks ago, to ask people to come down to get those dosages. But there is a step before that, which is, of course, addressing why the do not attends are happening. And that is what we are doing at the moment. Tayside Health Board have done a good power of work to try to understand that better, but I'm happy to give way.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Very much. I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way, and I'm sure the Chamber is very gratified to hear about the measures in Glasgow to deal with the hotspots there. But the hotspots and outbreaks of COVID-19 are not limited to Glasgow. And as I said in my speech, Davidson's Mains Primary was closed to my constituency on Tuesday. 11 classes are now self-isolating. There are dozens and dozens of infections there. Can he reassure my community that the government's focus is very much with them and that they will be receiving due attention?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I'm conscious, planning off, so I'm running short of time. I was coming to Lothian after Glasgow, and it was to say to Lothian that I spoke to the National Clinical Director, Jason Leach, this morning about our situation in Lothian. It is concerning. He will have seen the case numbers, as I have seen. We've recruited two additional mobile testing units in Lothian. They are focused on where the clusters are. In terms of Davidson's Mains Primary that he mentioned, if you'll forgive me, I'll go away and take a look to see whether or not there is the appropriate testing facilities there, and I will come back to the member and happy to engage with them directly in that regard. Yes, of course I will.
Craig
Hoy. On vaccines, will the Cabinet Secretary look into reports in today's East Lothian Courier, which suggests that residents are routinely being sent to vaccination centres in Middle Lothian and West Lothian, even when there is capacity in East Lothian? And if this is due to a computer glitch, should we, would the Minister get this sorted soon before it impacts both vaccine take-up and also the number of young people that may come forward in future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for raising the issue? I will take a look at that, and I will see why that is the reason. I'm conscious I'm very much out of time, Presiding Officer. We will be having a debate next week. In fact, our first debate next week is on the NHS and on NHS recovery. I look forward to giving more details of what I intend to do in that regard. But my ultimate priority, absolute priority of this government, not just my priority, but if this government is responding to the immediate crisis of COVID, but also ensuring that the NHS is recovered and remobilises, because we know, and I know, because I have some family members, I have a family member in particular, who is waiting for an operation, but COVID then came, and I know the impact it's having on that individual, and I am just one. And I will just end on this point and where I started, Presiding Officer, which is this has been an excellent debate. I'm pleased this has been the very first debate of this sixth session. I really look forward to working with all members, the new members, but those who are perhaps not so new either. And as much as this will be our collective focus, we will have plenty of disagreements, plenty of heated arguments. But ultimately, the people of Scotland have entrusted us to work together in a period of time that none of us could have envisaged, none of us could have imagined. And I am certain not just the government, but every single one of us, regardless of party colours and stripes, tribalism or any other issues of ideology that separate us or divide us, that ultimately on this issue, we will not let the people of Scotland down. Thank you, President.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on COVID-19, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice to bring forward decision time to now, and I invite the Minister to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you. I will now put the question. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and as there are no questions to be put as a result of today's business, I close this meeting.